please remember to check in at the check-in desk for each event.
In lane number 9, we've got Kyle Bernier. Lane 8, Jordan Williams. Lane 7, Corey Gibson. Lane 6, Ryan Knutson. Lane 5, Adam Klink. Lane 4, Nate Long. Lane 3, Ryan Reeves. Lane 2, Nathan Trevelyan. And lane number 1, Richard Essig. Less than a minute. Ten seconds. 10 seconds. Stand by. Individual event 3 presented by Trifecta. These guys are working on 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. Then they'll move into 100 double unders, 50 wall shots, 10 rope climbs, and then they've got to work their way back out from that. The dumbbell is 80 pounds. The wall ball is 30 pounds. Let's see how the men fare of Heat 1, beginning their day. This event with a 16-minute time cap. More than halfway on that 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. Corey Gibson and Nate Trevelyan. Both of those athletes are out in front. Trevelyan crossing that red line. He'll begin his 100 double unders. Followed very closely by Gibson. In lane number 1, Richard Essig out of CrossFit Hershey. Lane number 2, Nathan Trevelyan and your current heat leader out of CrossFit Suis Ponte West. Lane number 3 from SoGo CrossFit, Ryan Reeves. In lane 4 from Furian CrossFit, Nate Wall. Lane 5 from CrossFit Krypton, Adam Klink. Lane number 6 from Compound CrossFit, Ryan Knutson. Out of CrossFit Sacrifice in lane number 7, working on those 100 double unders, it's Corey Gibson. From CrossFit 441 in lane 8, Jordan Williams. And out of CrossFit Vitality in lane number 9, Kyle Bernier. Corey Gibson with the 1-rep, 2-rep lead over Jordan Williams as Jordan Williams and Nate Trevelyan try to catch Corey Gibson, your heat leader. So it is 1, Corey Gibson, and then a 2-way tie for Jordan Williams and Nate Trevelyan. But here come all the other fellas, all the players working on those 50 wall ball shots at 30 pounds. When they hit that 25 rep mark, halfway, signifying halfway, you will see them move over to the white plate. Nate Long taking a breather. Same story for Jordan Williams. Corey whips. Gibson keeps on cranking them out. which of these athletes is going to slide over first? It's going to be Corey Gibson in the red t-shirt, lane number 7, halfway, 25 reps remaining until he can move on to 10 rope climbs, as we're a little over 3 minutes in towards that 16-minute time cap. Nate Trevelyan also halfway, as is Ryan Reeves working on that second target. From what we've heard from previous competitors, they're saying this 50, these first set of 50, definitely they've got to work to get through them. But when they come back through, that second set of 50 is a whole nother ball game. Corey Gibson trying to keep the lead in lane number 7. He's in the red t-shirt. He's maintaining that lead with less than 5 reps remaining. A hand goes up for Ryan Reeves. Ryan Reeves just a couple of reps behind your leader, Corey Gibson. Corey Gibson is done with those 50 wall ball shots. He's getting some cheers from CrossFit Sacrifice. Ryan Reeves will also be joining him on those rope climbs. Corey with one, they've got to get through 10 of them. The short rope requires them to begin legless. And then once they get enough of that rope beneath their feet, they can hook in if they need to reach the top of that rope rig. Adam Klink working on his climbs. Trevelyan, a lot of the fellas now, the majority of the athletes onto their 10 rope climbs. We are 5 minutes in, fellas, 5 minutes in. Corey Gibson with at least 4 rope climbs in the bag. Ryan making a few moves, and now they are tied up for the lead. Ryan Reeves is in lane number 3. So it is Ryan Reeves and Corey Gibson who are fighting for the top spot in heat number 1 of men's individual event 3 presented by Trifecta. 6 minutes in, 10 minutes remain for these athletes. Your new leader is Ryan Reeves. Ryan Reeves going for another climb. Reeves with 3 more climbs to go, but right on his heels is Nate Trevelyan in lane number 2. 3 rope climbs for Trevelyan, 3 rope climbs remaining for Reeves. Now Trevelyan able to pull ahead. Your new leader in lane number 2 in the blue shirt, black shorts, Nate Trevelyan. Athletes. Reeves and Trevelyan both with 1 more rope climb. Trevelyan is going to strike first in lane number 2. And that'll do it for Nate Trevelyan, and it's back to the wall balls. Trevelyan and Reeves. Trevelyan with the 1 rep lead. That's all that separates Trevelyan from Reeves. Adam Klink making up some ground on those rope climbs. There's 10 reps for Adam Klink. Nate Trevelyan. So your new leader in lane number 5 from CrossFit Krypton, Adam Klink. Ryan Reeves at work in lane number 3. A lot of these fellas hanging out, catching their breath. 2 athletes doing work, make that 3 athletes doing work. And now several of the athletes back in action for heat number 1, event 3. 9 minutes in, guys. Adam Klink halfway, 25 reps to go. Nathan Trevelyan halfway. Ryan Reeves. Ryan Reeves may have taken the lead in lane number 3. Jordan Williams looking to get a set, a solid set in lane number 8 on his first set of 25 wall ball at 30 pounds. Coming up on 10 minutes. 6 minutes remain. 6 minutes remain. Atlanta, let's go ahead and help these guys out. Put your hands together. Ryan Reeves in lane number 3, about ready to be done with his wall balls. So go CrossFit's own Ryan Reeves, taking the lead in lane number 3. Adam Klink is about ready to join up. Get it up for Adam Klink. 11 minutes in. 5 minutes to go. Ryan Reeves able to get a set of double unders in first, but he's gonna take a breather. Meanwhile, Adam Klink picks up his rope and goes in lane number 5. Klink in the white shorts, Reeves in the black shorts. Here comes Nate Trevelyan. So it is 1 Reeves, 2 Klink, 3 Trevelyan. A 100 double unders, and then they need that 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. If you've got an athlete out here, I'm sure they could use a boost. Put your hands together for these athletes. Nate Long taking a step back from that wall ball. Trevelyan, Reeves, Klink. Trevelyan, Klink, chasing Klink, Klink, chasing Reeves. A little over 12 minutes into this event. Taking back the lead, put your hands together for Adam Klink. Klink able to pull ahead on those double unders. Seems to be handling those 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunges with 80 pounds just fine. Here comes Ryan Reeves. Forcing Adam Klink to continue to press on. 13 minutes in, 3 minutes to go, 3 minutes. 1, Adam Klink, 2, Ryan Reeves, three, Nate Trevelyan, and the rest of the guys are on their wall ball still. Corey Gibson onto his double unders. Meanwhile, Adam Klink grabbing that dumbbell and going in lane number five. Let's help him out, Atlanta. Put your hands together. He's almost there, just a few more steps. Cheer on, Adam Klink. Nicely done. Nate Trevelyan closing the gap between he and Reeves. Now Nate Trevelyan slides into second over in lane number two. Reeves picks up the dumbbell and goes. 2 minutes remain, less than 2 minutes remain. Nate Trevelyan going for it. We can get behind them, guys. Put your hands together. Oh, 10 feet remaining. He drops it. Can Ryan Reeves take Trevelyan, or will be Trevelyan be able to get it and go? 90 seconds. Who's it gonna be, Atlanta? It's Ryan Reeves, followed very, very closely, fractions of a second. Trevelyan will come in third. Woo! So at one Klink, two Reeves, three Trevelyan, by fractions of a second. Athletes, you have 1 minute to go. Corey Gibson on the doubles, Knutson on the doubles. Nate Long about ready to jump around over in lane number four. 45 seconds to go as Panier in lane number nine looks to make his way down to that finishing mat. He's got less than 40 seconds. Jordan Williams also on to the lunge. Guys, you have 30 seconds. Corey Gibson on the move. 20 seconds remain. 15 seconds, fellas. Counting down in 3, 2, 1, time. Big round of applause for our Heat 1 athletes. Shout out to Adam Klink for taking his heat. Heat 2, event 3, coming up next.
Here they come, ladies and gentlemen. Here come your Heat.
Moments ago in the warm-up area in the Georgia World Congress Center, the former champion and last year's second-place finisher, Ben Smith, getting his chip timer placed on his ankle. Today he comes in 19th place. He is 42 points out of a qualifying spot, trying to make a run on moving day here for day two of the Atlantic Regional. I'm Jeff Freimer alongside James Hobart. We'll hear from Amanda Krenz a little bit later. And that's the story right now. John Coley's in first place, but Ben Smith, maybe we took it for granted, has to make a big move.
I still think there's a lot of shifting you're going to see on the men's side of the field. Obviously, being out of 40 points out of fifth place isn't the end of the world, but it's not a place anyone really wants to be. Ben can do it, but he needs some really strong top five finishes.
Well, with his background in the CrossFit Games, whether it be regional or games, he's used to shifting around in the board. He is the last active male athlete that participated at the ranch.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we've seen so many new faces come in this year. And, you know, I don't think in the worst case scenario, if you don't see a Games without Ben Smith, I don't think it's the end of the world or, you know, kind of a turning of the tides or anything. It's just the nature of our community. And as we've tested more things, the tests have changed so much. Athletes have realized they've had to go further into new places in their training. But no other guy I'd rather have tackle this event as he works his way back up the leaderboard here. A lot going on. Starts off with that dumbbell overhead walking lunge. Double unders, wall balls. Where this workout gets serious is at that first set of wall balls, 50 at 30 pounds. Then those 10 rope climbs in the middle, back to those 50 wall balls. That's where you're going to see guys fall behind or pull ahead. So keep your eyes for that middle portion of the workout.
Underway, and Ben Smith will be in lane number 5 as we begin with the overhead lunge with the dumbbell. A lot of people at your local box may have done the barbell overhead lunges before. Lunges with dumbbells on the shoulders as we did in the open. This is a different animal.
Yeah, 80 pounds is not a lightweight. Certainly at this level, I think you'll see a lot of these guys do this first 100 feet unbroken. It's that back half 100 where we really are going to see the All-Stars shine. But not a too tall of an order of difficulty right now, even though it is an 80-pound dumbbell.
As you take a look at the 2015 champ, Ben Smith, he'll be in the blue top with those red knee sleeves. All eyes on lane 5 in heat number 2. So the lunges are over now to the 100 double unders. And kind of probably a neat experience for heat number 2ers, Norman Woodring and Uriah Avilas. They'll be flanked around the former champ. So that's really not bad for those guys, because Ben, you would imagine, will push the pace here. It's going to be good for those guys to try to follow him, help them up the leaderboard.
Working alongside the best in the world often can only make you better, and unless you get sucked into a pace that you can't hold. You know, that's one thing those guys will have to watch out for, especially on the wall ball here. I think it's easy to come out early on after those double under, grab that 30-pound wall ball and think something like, hey, I'm going to do a huge set and then just hang on for dear life. You got to have a plan with a workout like this.
Very steady. This is basically just kind of the appetizer till we get into the wall balls, rope climbs, and then the other 50 wall balls. This is an event that's somewhat similar as Ben Smith gets a big round of applause to the wall ball. It's not the same workout, but somewhat similar to the event you did in 2014, the 50s, when you go down the floor. You did the ring dips that year in the 50s, then made the turnarounds. This year they do the rope climbs, then they do the turnaround.
Having tested both of those work, having done one of those and tested this workout out, I'll tell you, the 50s is way worse. This is a little bit more challenging in a different way. I mean, it still is that middle portion of the workout. The ring dips in the 50s. Here it's this rope climb. But you just can't get too far ahead of yourself here, and you have to find a nice, easy cadence on that rope climb and not get to the point where you're accumulating too many no reps on that wall ball. If you get 2 or 3 in a row, it's time to just drop it, take a breath, ask your judge what's going wrong, and then carry on.
Purple shirt there was Norman Woodring next to Ben Smith. He uses the technique where he throws the ball, brings the arm down. It's a quick shake out, and it's ready to catch again.
Yeah, by driving the arms down to the side, it just prevents him from holding him overhead for too long. If you look to Ben's left, we see that athlete there, arms straight up overhead. Now, as Ben moves over to this second target, it doesn't mean he's done with this wall ball. It means he's at 25. He's halfway to his 50.
So, again, 25 on each side. And again, we're using that 30-pound wall ball again for the males here at the regionals. Smith very steady, as we would expect him to be.
This is a hard place to be in. You know, if you're an athlete who's used to being in that top five, those top spots, you know, I know I've heard Ben say before, hey, day one, I never do fantastic. Event one, I never do fantastic. But it makes it more difficult because now all the other heats coming after him have a time to chase if he comes out on top of this heat. And it's always easier to tackle a time. If you're not, you know, all the athletes who do the open announcements always say to me, hey, look, this is the worst workout of my life because you have no idea what you're about to tackle, and everyone else who's chasing you now has a pace, now has a methodology that they can look at. So not a great position for Ben to be in if he wants to climb back into top five.
Here's Ben Smith getting off the wall balls, and now he and Norman Wintering in the purple top on the ropes, and Norman Wintering going to keep pace with the champ and last year's second place finisher, four-time podium finisher, including that championship. Of course, we talk about the 19th place who make kind of a big deal out of it. Remember, Sean Sweeney had a 44th place finish week one, nearly came back, and even he admitted that final event six, he knew that was not going to be his event. Had it been a different event, maybe he makes a charge in the top five. So he's perfectly capable.
He's still finished. I mean, Sweeney, and I don't want to say nearly. Yeah, nearly in the sense he was sixth place, needed a fifth. He still finished 40 points out of fifth place. So, you know, I think Ben, if he really wants to make it happen, he's a strong finish here. And I'm sure he knows that too. And he's probably sick of hearing about it. As I've watched athletes go through this portion of the workout with the rope climb here, so they have to complete 10 rope climbs. Now, there are some challenges. You'll notice Ben kind of climbs halfway up, legless, leans back, gets his foot lock, and then it's one pull to the top. The challenge with this part of the workout is losing yourself in the rest period. There's a forced rest period. You got to come down from the rope. You got to go move your marker up on the rogue rig there so we know where your athlete is at. Now he's on his fifth rope climb. You need to find a pace where, and Ben's doing a beautiful job of this, experience shines through. You need to find a pace where you get your rep, you touch, you come down, you walk over, you avoid the chalk bucket at all costs, you move your marker on the rig, and then you're back up for another rope climb. Obviously, easier said than done. Ben looks like he's doing a really nice job here being methodical.
Again, those chips, the magnetic chips on the rogue rig, they'll move them up each round they complete. Most guys slide it up. You want to slide it. Don't want to detach it. You'd hate to drop the chip, and it's like a game of Plinko. You have to go run and chase it. He's got a good paced-out rhythm here. Steady, walks back, moves the chip, doesn't rush it.
You know, a lot of people say, you know, well, you just got to go as fast as possible. But, you know, experience is crucial here. You know, if you've done enough workouts, you've probably hit something like this. And Ben knows in the back of his mind that while the rope climbs are important, the front half of the workout is important. These 50 wall balls is going to separate the men from the boys here before they get ready to finish the back half of this thing.
Well, blew past him, and now he is back. And he's still got another one, but next to him, again, lane number four, Norman Woodring is putting on a nice little show out of Not the Norm CrossFit in Leesburg, Florida. As Ben Smith now has completed his 2015 fittest man on earth. Ben Smith, but again, Norman Woodring just to the right. Tommy has about a 7 or 8 rep lead. Woodring competed on the regionals a year ago for Unmatched. They finished 17th in the team division. Going individual this year for the 27-year-old who is 20th in the Southeast.
You know, we talk so much about just engine and gas and effort, but you see some really nice things from Ben Smith here. It's just the quality of the movement makes this workout better for him. You know, once he returns back to his wall ball, real quick, look at Norman Woodring there. As he squats down, knees pulling inside the toes a little bit, ball pulling him forward. We can see him gritting his teeth trying to hold that ball in the rack position. His torso starting to lean forward. Now, as we get to watch Ben, you see something really nice here. Knees out over the toes, torso really upright, elbows underneath the ball. You don't think that stuff matters, but let me tell you, if there's anywhere that you can save energy, That's going to give you extra energy for later on. So just not only does the movement matter in Ben there, but also, you know, the fitness piece too.
And another big key he does, he uses the hands under the ball for the catch so he can vault it up. I'm sure you see it coaching athletes. How many athletes do you see clamp down on the side of the ball? And you might not think you're expending a lot of energy clamping on the side, but you really are.
Yeah, it really is every little thing. All the muscles that you have to use to pull that ball into place, if it's pulling you out of place, that's just going to waste some energy and efficiency. The better the movement is here, the easier the wall ball will be. And I know everyone at home can attest to that.
Adam Klink here in the Atlantic earlier today at 13:48.
Fellow training partner of Ben Smith out of Krypton.
A little bit of no rep that time.
I'm trying to figure out what the no reps are. I don't think it's the depth. I think it's if Ben hits the just below the line or on the line with the ball, you got to get that ball up above that line in order for that rep to count.
Again, Norman Woodring moving along, but again, trying to get on that second set of 25. So Woodring on the second set of 25 when they move it back to the left. There are the lines, the black line for the males, the blue line for the females when they get back on the competition floor a little bit later. Ben Smith moves ahead of Norman Woodring, and now Ben Smith going back. 100 double unders. We'll make our way back to the other end of the floor.
Ben setting a really nice pace here, but still about a minute behind the event record pace set by Matt Frazier in the East a couple weekends ago.
So Woodring and Smith, 1 and 2. Followed by Marco Alejandro over in lane 3 at a CrossFit Westchester. He's in that purple shirt in the background, still on his wall balls.
And if you're Ben Smith right now, knowing you have that 100-foot lunge, you might not pay attention to it too much. You might not look over, but he notices Norman Woodring going down and kind of taking a knee and a break there. That's a relief as an athlete. You know, it's like, hell, I'll do anything to win this workout, but if anyone can make it easier by taking a break and getting off my back, I'm happy for that. You know, that's something he wants to see.
Waiting for the hand to go up for both of these athletes. And again, another break for Norman Woodring. And when you talk about competing and being next to your competitor, if you can catch him out of the corner of your eye, can just give you that boost of energy.
And here's what I want to see from the 2015 champ Ben Smith right now. I want to see this 100-foot lunge unbroken. You know, he has two heats. They're going to come after him. He's got to do something big here. A little bit of a slow start there, but we know Ben is strong overhead. I really hope he can hang on to hit a big score right now.
And Ben Smith, again, when you do these walking lunges, have to come all the way up. He's done plenty of these before. Halfway there. Quick drop to switch the hand.
50 feet in. That's a smart move. Maybe not unbroken, but didn't really mess around there. That's the kind of poise you want to have as an athlete who's going to do something big. You know, you see a lot of people when they do that switch, they walk around too much.
Listen to this crowd as he gets near.
Off of the event record pace set by Matt Frazier. Really nice job by Ben Smith. Good luck, heats 3 and 4, chasing that down.
Unofficially, 11:50. And in lane number 4, here comes Norman Woodring. He's put on a nice show as well. And that was a pre-planned break at about 50 feet for Smith, because he put it down to the left, immediately grabbed to the right, and went back up. That's a lot of experience, obviously. We don't have to go through the resume. We know what Ben Smith's done. He knows how to plan these things out.
It's always nice to see him do it, though. Looks like something's biting Norman Woodring every time he takes a lunge. He's got a little bit of grit in the teeth there, doing whatever he can to try and finish this thing in just 2 sets.
About 20 feet away.
Ow.
Getting stung each time he goes down. He'll have the second best time overall. Still 2 heats remaining. the Mount Norman Woodring out of Not the Norm CrossFit in Leesburg, Florida. Competing right next to Ben Smith and got a good pace off the former champ and puts up a really nice time.
That's a fantastic feeling as an athlete to chase down somebody of that caliber and have a really excellent finish there. So,
lane number 7, Bryce Lawler out of CrossFit RDU in Raleigh, North Carolina, a former collegiate soccer player, 24-year-old. He'll have to come back behind the dotted line. Marco Alejandro was hanging in there in the third overall, so Alejandro and Lawler. We'll see who gets down there first, but Alejandro broke early. Over in lane 2, Rodney Carter trying to chase these guys down. And look out in lane number 8. Here comes Hudson Frick out of Southern Moon CrossFit in Greenville, South Carolina.
I met Hudson a couple years ago at a CrossFit Level 2 seminar, and we do a heavy lift on day 2. Really strong guy. So I'd like to see him get back on this dumbbell as quickly as possible. Maybe try and move himself up into a third place finish in this heat.
This is going to be fun. We've got a 4-person race here. Rodney Carter way up in lane 2 in the army green. Alejandro in the purple. Shirtless, we've got Lawler. And in the gray shirt nearest to us is Hudson Frick.
And it looks like Frick's gaining some ground here on Lawler.
Lawler about 6 feet away. And it'll be Bryce Lawler out of CrossFit RDU. The next in will be Hudson Frick in lane number 8. Lane number 2, Rodney Carter out of CrossFit Bound in Kennesaw, Georgia. Just up the road from us here in Atlanta. He's going to be in just under 15 minutes. Have a 16-minute time cap, so a minute remaining. Marco Alejandro almost there, but he better watch out in lane 10. I believe it's Chris Killian. Maybe lane 9. Yep, Chris Killian. Killian out of Hardbat CrossFit in Newark, Delaware. Marco Alejandro, one more step. Just make sure that heels across the red line.
Had a really strong effort through the beginning of the workout. Struggled on that overhead lunge.
A little less than 30 seconds here for Chris Killian. 31st in the Atlantic a year ago, was team in 14 with Hardbat in the Mid-Atlantic.
Even if it's one or two steps at a time here, Chris Killian needs to just keep moving.
Former professional indoor football player out of Bridgewater College.
One more big step.
Chris Killian will complete the event in just under the time cap. Big thumbs up for the Bridgewater College alum. There's the guy that has the event lead and set a blistering pace of 11:50.
One of the biggest things we saw from Ben here, and I think the turning point, because he was a little bit behind the leaders at the first set of wall ball, was just being smooth through the rope climb, having a rhythm, not falling into somebody else's pace. And then on the way back, it was that second set of wall balls. Again, stayed diligent there, had a planned rest on his overhead walking lunge, and picked up the pace on the back 50. Ben needed this score. We need to see if it's going to hold up now.
The champion for 2015 is with Amanda.
Ben, you seemed so calculated as you moved through this particular event, especially on the rope climbs. So what was your plan going into this, and how did you pace yourself through it?
So I've done that event before, and I knew I just needed to stay relaxed, play my own game, and just, you know, there's two more heats left, so I got to do my best, I got to win the heat, and I got to win it well, so.
Yeah, that's hard when you know there's two heats left, right?
Sure, yes.
So what do you do now, focusing on what's ahead with the next event today and then the final day of competition tomorrow to get back up on that leaderboard?
I'm just going to go cool off, hydrate, and get ready for the next event. So just kind of mentally prepare, and I'll feel good to go.
What's it like for you having this crowd? They were really cheering for you today.
Yeah, you guys are awesome. Thank you guys so much. I'm thankful to God, thankful for my family and all the supporters we have here. So I feel very blessed. I'm very thankful, you guys. Thank you.
Thanks, Ben.
Yeah, thanks.
Ben Smith, officially 11:48:50. 13 is the time to beat, and that's a pretty good time for the next two heats to go after.
Very good time for them to chase down, and I think if anybody in those later two heats has a brain in between their ears, they were watching Ben Smith go through that to figure out, you know, where are the difficult parts, where can they speed up, where can they chase him down.
Heat 3 is on the way from Atlanta.
This heat, we've got Eric Oxley, Ethan Helbig, Benjamin Williams, Dane Smith, Mark Hutchinson, Joel DeZona, Daniel Petro. 1 minute. 1 minute. Jonathan Wall, Mark Oliver, and Aaron Hanna.
Ready for a heat number 3 of event number 3 here for the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm Jeff Bible alongside James Hobart. We'll hear later from Amanda Krenz. And Ben Smith set a really fast pace at 11:48.13 for heat 3 to chase after.
As these guys get ready to go, you don't want to just ignore the first half of this workout, but I expect them to get through this first 100-foot lunge pretty darn close to unbroken. The next 100 double unders, same thing. The workout starts with the wall ball, the rope climb, and then really that second set of wall ball at 30 pounds. Who can stay smooth in there and not waste it all on the front end?
So knocking out the 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge for the double unders, the wall balls, the rope climbs, then back the other way. This one-arm overhead lunge, we've seen axle bar lunges in the regionals, barbell lunges. We've all done lunges in the open this year with two dumbbells. One side is a little bit spicier. You really have to keep that midline.
Yeah, and it's an 80-pound dumbbell. It's certainly not light. And, you know, I bet if any of you athletes out there are listening, you have one arm that works a little bit better than the other. You want to be someone who can, on the back end, switch arms.
Mark Hutchinson will be the first to the double unders at 11th place at event number 2 right now, right at the midway line at number 20. He'd like to bump up a little bit today. There is, right next to him, Dane Smith. Dane Smith would like to make a move this afternoon.
He had a really strong finish in that dumbbell snatch ring dip workout yesterday. Obviously, no stranger to excellent training partners and having some competition around you. So it'll be neat to see how Dane can shake out in this one.
You'd be curious to watch Alec and Dane as we have this week in the past few years in the regionals. Obviously, they're probably testing these events with Ben Smith, with their brother, to see how they pace things out as well.
Yeah, and at a regional level until this weekend, we really haven't seen Dane or Alec step up to the level of their brother. They're doing pretty well here. Alec's in the next heat after this one. So be interesting to see at the end of today where the Smith boys shake out.
But again, here in lane 6, Mark Hutchinson out of Crucible CrossFit in Jacksonville, Florida, was on Forging the Warrior team. They were 7th in the Atlantic a year ago. Individually, 2 years ago, finished 36th here in the Atlantic.
Strong performance from Crucible this year. Team here as well. And Mark Hutchinson making them proud right now, I'm sure.
Dane Smith yesterday, we were talking about him at a 34th, but he bounced back with a 4th place finish in event number 2.
We've seen a lot of that all weekend across the board. I mean, in this heat, we see a lot of athletes who had a low 30s finish and then finish up in the single digits. So after today, it's going to take some time for those points to settle and see who really has a grip on one of those top 5 spots going up to Madison.
Aaron Hanna on your screen was 12th in the 2015 games. But here in heat number three, he needs a move as well. Tied for 19th place with Ben Smith.
Slightly taller athlete here, also very fit, but that height is going to give him a little extra advantage on those wall ball.
1 second 25 again. They switch targets at the halfway point. In a 16-minute time cap just into this event. It's the back half, as you mentioned. Once you get under the rope climbs in the back half, when you backtrack is where it counts. And that's one thing we'll watch Mark Hutchison in lane six as we take a look at Ethan Helbig here in lane number nine, unaffiliated. Had a fifth place finish in event number one yesterday.
Also another good example of one of those athletes who had a really strong finish yesterday and then a really brutal finish down in 35th place. So he wants to level that out.
On his second set of 25. Before you get to the rope climbs.
So pretty impressive pace by Helbig right now. He's about 2 seconds behind the event record pace set by Matt Frazier up in the east. But this is where we need to see, can he hold on to that pace?
And the red shirt again, Ethan Helbig, and you've got Benjamin Williams off to his left, your right on the screen. Again, the rope that we saw coming to the games last year, you have to go up the first portion legless. And you can engage the legs on the rest of the climb.
We see Helbig spending a lot of time on the chalk. Again, you can't say whether or not, you know, that was the turning point for him in the workout yet, but someone once told me, as soon as you reach for chalk, you've made the decision to lose the race. So I know there are cases where you absolutely need it. They are rope climbs. You got to keep your grip going well. But honestly, how much do you need?
Right now, your leaders, Helbig in first, Hannah in second, and Mark Hutchison in lane six. And earlier, Hutchison was a little bit ahead of the record pace. He's fallen off a little bit. But Aaron Hannah needing a big charge as well. We're back to Mark Hutchison. Again, out of Crucible CrossFit. Individual for the second time. Again, team a year ago. See where he moves his chip up to. I believe he's moving up to about the fourth spot as we go back to Helbig in lane number nine.
And this is the tough thing about this rope. You see Helbig there kind of struggling. He's taking these really big labored swings on the legless portion of the rope climb. You want to see the hands move quick, hand over hand, fast. And then he's taking even more time trying to get that footlock in. You'd like to see these things happen more efficiently. He's doing a nice job holding on here, but there's a good example. If you want to try and get that footlock first try, the more you have to search with it for your feet, the more the arms get worn out.
See Mark Hutchison find the rope fairly easily that time. And, of course, these ropes, unlike a longer rope that will lay on the ground and usually it doesn't move too much, the rope's off the ground. I've been on a rope off the ground, not this high. But if you're not under a lot of control, you can get the little helicopter spin. You can go swinging all over the place.
Yeah, you want to avoid the helicopter spin at all costs.
Back to lane number one, Aaron Hannah out of CrossFit West Chase in Tampa, Florida.
Now, I'm surprised to see something on Aaron Hannah here. He sort of took two little steps with his footlock there to get up the rope. He's a tall athlete. You know, what he should look for here is one or two legless, get a higher footlock in, and then that was better, much better than his previous rep. One stand and touch. He should take advantage of that height, and there he is on his 10th rope climb. So, solid work by him so far.
So, Aaron Hannah in the lead, followed by Helbig and Hutchison.
There you go. Typically, the tall athletes. We have Richard, we had Vestig yesterday, 6'3". The taller athletes always say that they're not built for CrossFit, but when it comes to wall ball, when it comes to rope climb, no one could be better built for CrossFit than taller athletes.
So on to the back half of the 50 wall balls. That's what I try to tell athletes at your local boxes. Yes, you're a taller athlete. Maybe you don't dive under the bar quickly on the barbell and some other movements, but you got to crush those guys on the rower, on the wall balls, or get up on the rope climb. So it's going to even out.
Yeah, over the long term, you know, your fitness favors the fit.
You should brand that right now. The Hobart shirt.
It's a couple of people I'd have to talk to first.
Right. So Helbig back on his wall balls as well. Sneaking up on lane number four, Daniel Pietro. He's a games veteran from back in 2013. He finished 13th that year, and he's quietly creeping up. Eighth in the Atlantic a year ago. Multiple time, Regal Lathley. Again, his breakthrough year was 2013, his rookie season. He struggled to get back since then.
He's got legs on him like a rhinoceros, so I think if he can, the breath can keep up with the body, he should be able to hammer through these wall balls pretty effectively.
And that's been the rub on Pietro, a very strong athlete, but some of the endurance events have caught up with him. In time to beat Ben Smith, set at 11:48:13.
I think if these guys are looking for a chance to chase down Ben's time, they have to be off these wall balls close to 9 minutes.
Eric Oxley off to the left of the purple shirt, and again watching Helbig.
We saw Helbig struggle a little bit on the rope climb and the pacing there, but I will say he's given the rest of this workout some hell. His tenacity is impressive there, especially on the wall ball, staying diligent, even working through those no reps.
So this is the grindy part. You put your head down, get through the 50 wall balls. They'll be under fatigue, but the double under should not be that huge of an obstacle. And then another kind of grind it out to get through those lunges. How much pain can you go through and keep that midline to the last 100 feet?
A lot of these guys look pretty close. I'm really hoping for a little bit of a foot race on that dumbbell overhead walking lunge. It's a great way to end this workout.
Dane Smith in lane number 7, moving the chip, still on the rope climbs. Well, not just the Smiths, but just a whole lot of CrossFit Krypton athletes out here this weekend we've talked about between Krypton and Peak 360. They've got a large chunk of athletes.
Surprising, Dane struggling there with getting his foot lock in. That's going to kill your upper body on the rope climbs. You know, he's probably strong enough to do a couple of these legless. We need to get to the point where it's one or two pulls, then the feet lock in.
But that's what we were talking about earlier on that short rope. The rope kind of bouncing away from him, where the long rope that drags on the ground, it's easy to catch that with your feet. On to the double unders in lane 1, Aaron Hanna. Got a minute 48 to get through these double unders and get that dumbbell to the other end of the floor. And if he wants the new time to beat. Very steady on these double unders, which we'd expect these regional athletes, even under some fatigue, to be steady. Here is Helbig now in lane number 9. Right next to him will be Benjamin Williams in lane number 8. So Benjamin Williams has quietly moved up out of CrossFit Passion in Alpharetta, Georgia. Pietro now on to the double unders. Again, 11:48:13, set by Ben Smith in the last heat. So they've got just a bit over a minute. And again, that's an aggressive time to beat from a heat. That's not your normal heat, too. You're talking about a guy that was second on the podium last year, the champion 2 seasons ago.
Yeah, and sometimes that can be tough. You know, here's the downside of that. Maybe you come into this in heat 3 saying, all right, Ben set the pace. I'm going to chase that down. If that pace is a little bit too far out of your reach, you come blazing through the first half of this workout, and you burn yourself out too much, and you don't even end up hitting the time you could have hit because you exhaust yourself trying to chase down Ben's time.
Well, Helbig's not stopping, but in lane number 1, here comes Aaron Hanna, a games veteran. Again, we'll need to be very steady as he continues the walk down lane number 1. Obviously, when he puts it down quickly, you don't want that dumbbell coming out in front, but also you don't want it behind you too severely. Ultimately, you want it that straight line. It's easier said than done on the back half.
Yeah, and this is the window Helbig needed. I just saw him look over and up at Hanna. We saw Hanna put it down after about 20 feet. A little bit unsteady on the dumbbell lunges. Now Helbig here gaining some really solid ground. I mean, this is what gets you fired up as an athlete. You see that guy that you're racing start to have the speed wobbles? That's when you got to go in for the kill, and Helbig is doing a nice job here. He's got to hold on past halfway.
He is catching up. Helbig in the pink shorts, and it's going to be Hanna in the blue shorts at the top. Now Helbig breaks. Here comes Hanna.
And you see
Hanna's got to know.
Looking over left and right, he knows he's got guys. You know, the sharks are starting to surround him. There's blood in the water. Pietro, like we said, strong legs, moving confidently with this dumbbell. These guys need to get past that 50-foot marker.
Helbig will overtake Hanna. Now they are lunge for lunge. Hanna about a length ahead. And as they say, down the stretch they come. Step for step. It's Helbig. Maybe a half step. Now Hanna And Hannah can hang on in lane one in the blue, but here's Helbig. He's across. Who gets to the mat first? Ethan Helbig edges out Aaron Hannah.
And he should be excited about that finish there. That was absolutely amazing. Struggled on those rope climbs, but held fast on those lunges to get through.
Daniel Pietro dropped at the line. He had to come back. He will get in at a little over 13:15. Lane 8, Benjamin Williams in the red shorts. Boy, Helbig left it all on the floor. Again, these were nice times. Ben Smith hangs on to the time to beat. Mark Hutchison in lane 6 in the red. He's in a bit of a race in lane 3 with Jonathan Wall in the gray shorts. Remember, Hutchison had the time early and, in fact, was ahead of the bit record coming off the first set of double unders. 16-minute time cap here in event number 3. Wall trying to chase him down, but finally breaks. So Mark Hutchison on to bring it on in. Can get that big step. And he does. That's always kind of the worst feeling. I remember in the Open, if you just have that step and you know it's just a couple inches out of your normal stride, can you get that heel across that line?
Yeah, you know, a lot of people always ask, what's your strategy for a workout like this? Well, do it on broken. Well, what happens if you fail? It's too bad. You know, at this point in the game, this day, you know, day 2 moving day, you're going to have to stretch yourself thin if you want to climb back up that leaderboard.
Jonathan Wall is in. The 27-year-old collapses onto the finish mat. Just over a minute, about a minute 15 remaining. Lane 10 to the bottom of your screen. Eric Oxley in the purple short from Down East CrossFit in Hampstead, North Carolina. He's on Team Maximus's games team back in 2015. They were 7th place overall.
Very strong athlete down there when he competed with Maximus.
Less than a minute left. Lane 5, Joe DeZona out of CrossFit Valdosta, Valdosta, Georgia. Twice in the Regionals in 14, he was 11th in the Southeast. Just missed the games in 13 when he finished 4th.
Stretch to finish there. I love seeing that. Anything not to do an extra lunge. That's fantastic.
We're 20 seconds left. That's what I was talking about here in the Open. Just get the heel across the line. I do not want to do 2 steps.
That's how you want to finish that workout. You don't want to finish that workout and feel great. You want to know you gave it 100%.
Dane Smith back on the wall balls. And he is going to cap out at 16 minutes. What a fun race to watch.
Really impressed with Helbig. You know, during the rope climbs, I got a little bit worried about what was going on. He's over there making a chalk sandwich or something, but he held fast. And the thing that made the difference for him were the wall balls on both ends. He got really big sets, minimized some no reps there. And then at the end, when he smelled blood in the water, he saw Hannah stumble. He was able to push through and finish those lunges fast. So very impressive finish from Ethan Helbig. And he's clearly either surprised or fired up about what happened. So awesome to watch that.
Ben Smith hangs on to the time to beat. Doesn't hang on. He has it by a lot. Ethan Helbig, a nice time at 12:55. That's what it looks like now through 3 heats. We have 1 heat remaining here from the Georgia World Congress Center, and it is on the way from Atlanta. One heat remaining here in event three on day two for the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta, Georgia at the Atlantic Regional, as these 10 athletes, the last 10, trying to chase down Ben Smith time of 11:48. I'm Jeff Bryant alongside James Hobart. Later on, we'll hear from Amanda Krenz on the floor. Here's how it looks coming into day number two in the Atlantic. John Colty leading the way with 173 points, but really, Ryan Elrod holding on to that final spot to Madison, Wisconsin.
You know, I won't say I'm shocked to see John Colty up there. He's had a lot of regionals experience competing on a team that last year that finished sixth place. But that day one, we can see a lot of changes coming into day two. The workouts are very different. Can these new faces hold these top spots?
There's John Colty right in the middle of your screen on the left side, and Noah Olson off to his right. This should be a fun race here. It's going to be a long time domain, so we'll probably see the lead shift back and forth. Get a 16-minute time cap.
And you talk about that lead shifting back and forth. Like we said earlier, it starts off with that long lunge. I don't think that's, you know, not that I don't think. That's not where the race is won. We got to watch the 50 wall shots in the middle, the 10 rope climbs. Are athletes wasting too much time getting chalked up, walking around? And then it is, can they stay steady and close to that ball on those 50 wall ball shots at the end? Is anyone going to go unbroken on that 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge with 80 pounds to round this one out? They're going to need to if they want to catch Ben Smith's time.
Here is how they will line up. And you just saw Colton in lane 5 and Noah Olson in lane 6. Josh Miller in lane number 8 is just on the outside, just 2 points behind Ryan Elrod. As we take a look at Josh Miller out of CrossFit Spartanburg in South Carolina. Knows what he has to do. He's trying to track down Ryan Elrod. Only 2 points away, so if he can beat Elrod down in lane number 3, depending on how many are between, could be in the top 5 spot before we get to event 4. We're about ready to go. Underway here in heat number 4. Overhead walkie lines, 100 feet before you get to the 100 double unders. And again, we'll see the overhead lunge. We've seen it before in the regionals, but it's been with an axle bar or a barbell. First time we're doing it with one hand as you taking a look at Alex Smith, the third Smith brother. His brother holding the top time at 11:48.13.
Now you notice a couple of these guys are stepping through their lunge, and that's going to speed up their pace down the floor. We see Noah out in front stepping through the lunge. He's not pausing at the top of each rep. I'm curious to see, can they do that on the back end of this workout too? Most people had to stop and bring their feet back together before continuing the lunge.
Nathan Bramlett just off to his right. He's a games vet trying to return, but Noah Olson got to those double unders quickly. But again, as you mentioned, this is not where it's won or lost. Second place, trailing Colty by 12 points. He's got a 21-point cushion in the top 5. 15th a year ago of the games, he's had a couple of top 10s in 14 and 15. Would really like to bounce back, break through, get back with the top 10, maybe make a run at the podium.
Yeah, and we've seen Noah have some great success with chippers before last year, an event, I believe it was event 5 or 6. At regionals that ended with those overhead squats. He did very well in that event. I believe he won it down here at the Atlantic Regional. So expect him to perform well here, but I wonder, does he go out too hot and then burn himself out to hold a good pace on the back end? Because right now, he is moving at a blistering pace. I've never seen anyone do double unders faster.
Now on a 50 wall balls. Again, they'll move over to his right when he gets down to 25. There's Nathan Bramlett just off to the left in the light green shirt.
Another guy chasing to get back to the games went in 2015. I spoke with Nathan earlier, and he said, you know, everyone said this. I really wanted to get through day one. He said, I'm excited about the workouts here on day two.
Bramlett has a 7-point lead on Josh Miller, who is in sixth place. So right now, Bramlett on the good side of the red line. And all the athletes onto the wall balls. Again, as long as they're on the target to the left, they are in the first 25. The target to the right will be the final 25. And Noah, a little bit ahead of record pace right now. We've seen several athletes, once they get to that first set of double unders, out very quickly ahead of record pace. But where will they be once they come back off the rope?
Yeah, that 30-pound wall ball always has a lot to say about your ability to hit an event record. So we'll see if these guys can hang on as both Noah and Nathan move over to that 26 to 50 rep target.
I think I mentioned this earlier in team competition today. If you're just starting CrossFit or you're just kind of watching for the first time and you say, well, what's the big deal? It's just 10 pounds heavier. CrossFit, you talk about moving a load a long distance for time, and you've got to do the math. You take 10 pounds times 50 wall balls here plus another 50. That's 500-pound extra work here. It's going to end up being 1,000 pounds more work than you do with your standard 20-pound wall ball.
Yeah, it's a lot more work, and all the uncomfortable positions that a 20-pound wall ball pulls you into, the 30 is going to do the exact same thing. I mean, the better squatter you are here, tall or short, fit or not fit, you already have a little bit of an edge. So there's a lot of factors that play into making this a little bit easier. Noah is absolutely flying now. I thought he was finished there with those wall balls. I take it back. He's moving fast, but I don't know about absolutely flying.
Olsen, no trouble getting the depth. We go down to Travis Mayer. He is another Games athlete, 10th a year ago. A quiet athlete. When you would say to a general fan, let's talk about the top 10, they probably would never mention Travis, but he's 29th and 14th, missed 15th, came back for a top 10 a season ago. Just very unassuming, just goes to work, and he's in lane number 9, moving along, back to Noah Olsen in lane number 6. So right now you have Mayer, who's actually leading Olsen. Connor Duddy is currently in third place. Travis Mayer right there with him.
And between Bramlett, Olsen, and Mayer, let's see who can go for the chalk bucket last.
Duddy yesterday had an 8th place finish in event 1, dropped to a 14th place overall, but he only sits 12 points out of a qualifying position. And Olsen 12 points behind Colty.
You know, we talk about day 2 being moving day, and we also talk about, you know, saving yourself for the rest of the weekend. However, there's only 40 points between 5th and 19th. You want to go into day 3 with a little bit of leeway. So if there's a time to maybe step on the gas a little harder, it's right now.
You just saw John Colty jump on the rope. That is his first rope climb. Back to Connor Dunney in lane number 1 out of CrossFit Solidarity in Charlottesville, Virginia. Again, had a great story. We talked about it yesterday, but just to repeat it quickly, a former rower suffered a serious back injury, used CrossFit as a chance to rehab, said the beauty of CrossFit, and we talked about it, infinitely scalable, able to work himself back. And he's about halfway through his rope lines. Again, you'll see him move that chip up. This is your overall leader coming into this event, but unless he starts to really move, Noah Olsen could have that top spot by the end of event 3, and Travis Mayer's on his last rope climb. So Mayer, last year's 10th place finisher in Carson, is back to 50 wall balls. He wants to go from Carson to Madison.
And he's about 13 seconds ahead of the event record pace set by Matt Frazier.
Really nice depth on the squat and the bottom of the wall ball. We've talked about several techniques and points of performance, things you want to do, as Noah Olsen's on his last rope climb. One thing at least I prefer, you see people sometimes ride the line on the depth, but to me, and maybe I'm completely wrong on this, I'll let you explain it, but if you're riding that line, you're slowing your momentum down. I like to get the bounce out of the bottom of the squat like a piston on the wall ball.
Yeah, then that can go two ways. One, if you ride down a little lower, a little harder, you can get a little bounce, which might give you some momentum to push the ball up. However, every inch of range of motion you add is another inch of range of motion. You have to move that weight, which can eat up some time, so you got to keep that in mind as well.
Ryan Elrod in the blue shirt and the yellow pants. Elrod holds the final spot by 2 points over Josh Miller. Right now, he is in 5th place at a CrossFit Waterside in Orlando, Florida. Back to his first set of 25 on the wall balls. Again, the top 3. Travis Mayer in first. Elrod has now moved into second. Noah Olsen has dropped to third. So Elrod doing what he needs to do here to stay in that top 5. And Travis Mayer, 5 left before he wraps it up and moves over. and around 25 remaining.
And he has about just under, he's about 50 seconds here. If he wants to stay ahead of that event record's pace set by Matt Frazier, he needs to get off the wall ball before about 8 minutes 40 seconds.
And if he's anywhere near flirting with that one, that also means he's well ahead of the time to beat by Ben Smith of 11:48.13. In 8th place, after a couple of events, Mayer sits only 12 spots or 12 points away from Ryan Elrod. And Mayer is leading Elrod, but there's not going to be enough people, I think, between Mayer and Elrod, but there might be between a Jake Berman and Aiden Bramlett. He could jump Jacob Anderson before this is all said and done. Back to Noah Olsen in his final 25 wall balls. And Elrod in the yellow shorts. He's done away with the shirt. It's time to get down to business on the back half of this event.
Don't want to add any extra weight to that wall ball.
Less than 5 reps, and Mayer will get on his next set of 100 double unders.
At this point, he's about 20 seconds behind that event record. However, I think he's still pretty close to matching Ben Smith's time.
Got about 2.5 minutes before Ben Smith's 11:48.
I will say this, on the way down, Travis Mayer was one of the slower athletes with the dumbbell overhead walking lunge. So it'll be interesting to see if maybe he was saving himself or he'll be able to use that time to catch Ben.
Travis Mayer here in lane number 9. Again, a 2-time Games veteran, 3rd here in the Atlantic last year. Just missed the Games in 15 when he finished 8th. He was the 3rd qualifier in 2014 down to the Southeast. And Noah Olsen, 1 wall ball remaining. Here is Elrod again. Ryan Elrod again. He hangs on to the final spot in 5th place.
Elrod making a very strong statement about how badly he wants to hold on to that spot right now.
Down in lane 1, Connor Duddy still hanging around, and Duddy in 9th place overall, and he is points-wise tied with Jacob Anderson, Travis Mayer, himself, Alex Smith, but Anderson and Mayer have a tiebreaker over him. So really a group of 4 right there equal at 7th place.
These double unders are important, but we're going to have a heck of a foot race here heading down for the overhead walking lunge of who's going to take probably that 2nd place spot. Unless Travis has some huge issues right now.
Well, if it's even close to the foot race we had where Ethan Helbig just outpaced his competitor a heat ago, it's going to be a thriller. But Mayer getting a little bit of distance.
And for everybody in 2nd place, that's what you want to see. That's the chance they might need to catch up to him here.
He's still the only athlete on the overhead lunge. Mayer's got to go back, a little stumble.
So you got to make sure that when you step through that lunge, if you bring your feet together, you don't shuffle them at all. You have to take a nice, clean step out into that next lunge.
Still the only athlete onto the lunge.
I don't know what his judge told him, but things seem to be moving a lot better now.
Ryan Elrod now picking up his dumbbell. And Elrod on the way down the floor. And it's going to be Elrod and Noah Olsen in a battle for 2nd here in this heat.
And it looks like none of these guys are going to beat Ben Smith's time. Ben will take a 1st place in this event heading into event 4.
You heard a roar go up at the 11:48 mark. These fans very knowledgeable. They know exactly what just happened. As Mayer trying to get a 2nd place, and again, we'll have to go back. Make sure that knee touches the ground. Here comes Olsen behind him. Olsen, a blistering pace. Can Mayer hold him off? 2, maybe 3 more steps.
Huge no rep there, pulling Noah back.
Travis Mayer in about 12:30, and that's going to be good for 2nd overall in the event. If Noah Olsen can get in at 12:55, he'll have 3rd in the event. But look out in lane 10. It's Alex Smith. Alex Smith may edge Noah Olsen. Alex Smith is in. Alex Smith puts it down. A no rep for Noah Olsen. And now it's going to be Ryan Elrod who comes in. A couple of costly no reps for Noah Olsen.
And you talk about a perfect scenario for someone like Ben who's trying to climb back up into that top five. You need everyone who you beat to come in between you and the other top five guys.
Nathan Bramlett comes in about 13, 15. That may keep him in the top. Here's Josh Miller in lane 8 in the red top. He'll come in right about 13 and a half minutes. Lane number 4, Jake Berman out of CrossFit Borough in Statesboro, Georgia. Right behind him in lane 2, Jacob Anderson. Anderson is in.
That's a brutal no rep for Berman.
It's like he's just having trouble keeping that dumbbell straight overhead.
And he seems to keep using that right arm. Maybe it's just that the left arm doesn't hold it as well, or something else is going on there.
Finally, he is in about 14:02. Lane number 1, Connor Duddy. Here is Coley. He was your leader coming in. He's about a minute 35 away from the time cap. And for each second he's taking here in the final heat, trying to see how many spots are potentially falling here. At 14:36, it's already where the ninth place spot was in this event. And it was bunched up so tight, the top five, he could be losing a top five right here, not just the overall lead.
And he only has about 30 points between himself and fifth place, so this could put a big dent in his plans to head to Madison.
Almost there. A couple of more steps. And in about 15:12, and I'm not even sure that's going to get him into the top 20 in this event. We'll wait for the official results, but Travis Mayer did a really nice job here.
I think the big thing for Travis Mayer was, one, he pulled ahead on the rope climbs. Obviously, had a really nice technique there, was nice and fast, but I think it was the sets of the wall ball that got him ahead. He had some bigger sets there, moved fast, stayed aggressive in his pacing. He did not have a great time on the dumbbell overhead walking lunges. He had some mess-ups on the double unders. I won't say he got lucky, because that's effort and that's skill, but he did get away with a little bit there. When Noah got those no reps to finish off the lunges strong and get a second place for that event and the heat win.
May put him in the top five. He is with Amanda.
Travis, you're an experienced games athlete. What was going through your mind during that last stretch of those overhead lunges?
Try not to put it down. Shoulders are way more fatigued than I anticipated, so that last set was a little bit of a struggle more than I thought.
What's this competition been like for you with your fellow athletes who are out there on the floor?
Oh, it's great. You know, it's great to be surrounded by all you guys here, and then all the athletes are really good, so you can't slack up on a workout, so you just got to come to show and do good.
What are you focused on now for the next events?
Try to win.
Well said. Thanks, Travis.
All right, thank you.
Travis Mayer, a 12:30, second place overall. That may get him into the top five, but Ben Smith in heat two threw it down with an 11:48 to get the event win here. So we'll see how much that pushes him up the leaderboard. That does it for event three for the men. The women are on the way, but before we have the women's individual from the Atlantic, we will get an update from the HQ studio.
Welcome back to CrossFit HQ. Sam Farber here with Games OG, Annie Sakamoto. And Annie, day two of regionals is definitely about a return to normalcy. Meridian Regional, we saw Annie Thorisdottir get back on top in a regional event win. And now Ben Smith here today.
Yeah, well, the Atlantic region is such a great race right now. There was only 31 points that separated first from fifth place, and only 42 points separating that fifth place from Ben Smith, who was tied for 19th place. Ben Smith did exactly what we all wanted to see him do today, what we knew he was capable of doing in winning that first event today. It is moving day, just like you said. Some things should hopefully start to normalize today, and that was a great start for Ben in that direction.
We are working hard to get the updated numbers for you, so we'll hopefully by the end of this show be able to show you where Ben Smith has moved within the standings. Right now, though, let's take a look at the women's standings as they get set to start day number two. Emily Bridgers in first place by way of a tiebreaker over Cassidy Lance McWhorter. Breonna Evans leads Anna Tobias by just 1 point for the fifth and final qualifying spot headed here into day number two. And that means event number three for the women coming up right now. Pretty much the same thing you just saw for the men, but some slight alterations. Let's take a look at what's ahead here for the women with the event record held by Annie Thorisdottir. That's from earlier today, 11 minutes and 42 seconds. Again, this is dumbbell, double unders, wall balls, rope climbs. Same thing as the men, different weights. What are your thoughts on who this event favors and what to watch for?
Well, you know, as far as this event goes, I think really what a lot of it comes down to is the meat of that chipper, and that would be the 50 wall balls, which are at a heavier weight, into the 10 rope climbs, back into those 50 wall balls. So depending on the kind of athlete you are, managing those wall ball sets. But what we're also really seeing is on that rope climb, we see a lot of people fumbling with their feet, trying to either latch on too soon or having too wild of a kip on the initial first pulls in that rope climb, and then spending a lot of extra energy trying to figure out how to get their feet on the ropes. So it's really going to come down to the wall balls, the rope climbs back to those wall balls. For that reason, I'm actually going to pick Whitney Galin on this event. She is an athlete that qualified in the Atlantic region in 2015. She had a great CrossFit Games rookie appearance that year, finishing in 19th place. Then she moved to CrossFit New England last year and finished in seventh, unfortunately, in a really tough East Regional. She moved back to the Mid-Atlantic region this year. She now trains with Margot Alvarez. Margot has already qualified in the South region. I'm sure she's talked to Whitney about how to attack these events. And last year, Whitney, actually her best finish was in the third event, which was 104 wall balls, 52 pull-ups. So looking at that, looking at the fact that Whitney is one of the tallest athletes in the region, I think that this is going to be her workout.
We had the updated standings for the men after event number three. Noah Olson in first place, 232 points. And there is Ben Smith up to ninth. He's made up about 25, 30 points from prior to event number three to now post-event number three. So that's a big move for Ben Smith. Still a lot of work to do with half the competition still remaining. Here's the schedule of events for the remainder of the day. A reminder, out in the West region, they'll be doing team events right now. Men and women alternating events three and four all through the afternoon. All times are local to whichever region is being competed. How to watch it? You can do it at games.crossfit.com on our Facebook page. Make sure it's the CrossFit Games version, or on YouTube and the great second screen experience available on our facebook.com/CrossFit page. Lots to watch. Lots going on with the women now ready to tackle event number three. Let's get you back out to Atlanta.
Richards. Lane number 7, Jill Simon. Lane number 8, Laura Nielsen. Lane number 9, Lindsay Jacoby. And in lane number 10, Brittany Weiss. Under 1 minute. Athletes on your starting mats, 30 seconds. Seconds. Athletes, stand by. And heat number 1 of your individual female competition now underway here in the Atlantic. Same event as you just watched with our gentlemen. 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge right into 100 dubs. Then it's 50 heavy wall balls with a 20-pound ball for our ladies to a 9-foot target. The middle movement of this chipper, the pinnacle, if you will, 10 rope climbs. And then it's back down, 50 wall balls, 100 dubs, and 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge. Your early leader down in lane number 1, Laura Gonzalez out of CrossFit Seoul, Miami. Just about 10 feet to go. Jillian Simon with 10 feet to go, as will Hannah Richards. But it'll be Laura Gonzalez onto the double unders first. Second onto the dubs. Your next three, rather. Simon, Weiss, and Jacoby. All lanes 9 and 10, getting right on into their dubs. Lane number 9, blue sports bra, black pants, Lindsay Jacoby. One of 6 CrossFit Krypton individual competitors competing out here this weekend. Just watched Adam Klink, Alex Smith, and of course, Ben Smith dominate. Let's see if that gives her some motivation to start in heat number 1 with a solid performance. And up in the air down in lane number 10, the exercise physiology major from UNC, Brittany Weiss, getting started on her wall balls first. Next will be in lane number 3, Megan O'Donnell. CrossFit Ridge Abs' very own. Nicknamed Breezy. As just like with our men, they're going to do their first 25 on the left target, then move on over to the right for their second set of 25. As we approach the 3-minute mark, looking for who's going to move on over first. Hand up in the air for Brittany Weiss. A few more reps to go, and she will head to the right target now. If I am not mistaken, she is your leader. Now Megan O'Donnell moving over to the right target, as will Laura Gonzalez. Rochelle Egrid. Moving on over to the right target. Columbia native transplant down to the Atlantic, making her regional debut. The next movement, those 10 rope climbs, which we saw with our men, was a major factor and will especially be with our ladies as Hannah Richards moves over to that right target. Looking to see whose hand goes up in the air first to signal those final five repetitions. And there it is, Laura Gonzalez. Final couple of reps, and she is on to the rope climbs. As we mentioned, these are not your typical rope climbs, as now Megan O'Donnell and Brittany Weiss get ready to go. Laura making her first ascent. And the first one looks pretty darn good. A couple of legless pulls, gets her feet in there. Two more pulls, that's one climb. Megan O'Donnell looking for her first, as she'll lock her feet in. And she'll get climb number one. Let's see how Brittany Weiss is doing. Moving that marker up to rep number two. Again, you can follow along with their progress, if you can see those numbers inside the rig on those uprights. The number that the marker is on is the rep that they are working towards completing. Laura Gonzalez, two rope climbs in. Megan O'Donnell touches for her second climb. Mitchie Eggert gets her first. Jillian in lane number seven gets her first. Let's see how Brittany Weiss locking that rope between her legs as now she gets her feet in there. That is three rope climbs for Brittany. Just over 6 minutes in, as Laura Gonzalez looking to hang on to her lead as she stands up. One little baby pull there, and she will have four rope climbs down. Tommy DePrima also now working on her climbs, two climbs down. Also representing CrossFit Soul Miami. She'll get ready to jump back up. Mitchie Eggert done with three. Brittany Weiss jumps up and does what we saw originally back in week number one. Katrin David's daughter squeezing that rope between her thighs. One pull, locking that feet up. She's over the hump. Five climbs in for Brittany Weiss. Trying to see if anyone can best that. Laura Gonzalez, six climbs down. So it's gonna go one, Laura Gonzalez, two on the opposite end of the rig, Brittany Weiss, and then three appears to be Megan O'Donnell in lane number three. Mitchie Eggert, though, right there with her as they both are making their fifth ascent. So both will have rope climb at number five in the bag. Lindsay Jacoby just a climb behind them as Brittany Weiss begins climb number seven, trying to keep those arms close to her body as she locks up her feet and she'll touch. Three more to go for Brittany Weiss. How about Laura Gonzalez? She's gonna jump up for climb number eight. So just a step ahead using big sweeping kips as she will touch. Two more to go for Laura Gonzalez. Brittany Weiss trying to tie it up with the athlete on the polar opposite side of the rig. That'll be climb number 8 for Brittany. But here comes Laura. This is climb number 9. And a brand new day for Laura as she's 9 down, 1 more to go. Looking to see where everybody else is, if they are indeed close. The only one that could potentially catch her would be Brittany Weiss, but it'll be Laura up the rope first. Beginning climb number 10, can she get to the top? Making her regionals debut and starting off day 2 the right way, done with her climbs first. Laura Gonzalez-Marin back to the wall balls in lane number 1. One climb to go for Brittany as we near the 10-minute mark. A 16-minute capped event. But Laura's over the biggest hurdle on this one, those 10 rope climbs. Hannah Richards, 7 reps in. Brittany Weiss gonna begin her 10th and final climb. College Hill CrossFit, I see you back there. Make some noise for one more pull. And Brittany Weiss back to the wall balls. So they will be your 1 and 2, and nobody else even within 2 rope climbs of these 2 athletes. As they both get started, the next closest would be Bailey Garrett, who's about to begin her 10th and final climb. Anna Richards, 2 more to go. And Lindsay Jacoby with 2 more to go. So they're gonna be your next closest competitors. As Brittany Weiss takes a rest. Bailey Garrett done. She's gonna now get on to her set of wall balls. So check that out, 25 in for Laura Gonzalez. As she does a set of 2 there on the left target. The question on my mind, does Laura or does Brittany have the time to finish this one up beneath the cap? 16 minutes, less than 5 minutes remaining as Bailey Garrett and Megan O'Donnell will now join them. Anna Richards is done. Brittany Weiss, 25 reps in. Let's check in with Laura Gonzalez and see how many reps she's got. 7 more to go for Laura Gonzalez as she takes another rest. 4 minutes remaining for 100 dubs in that 100-foot overhead walking lunge. There's a hand up in the air. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to see an athlete finish this one beneath the cap. Let's give her a boost. Final few reps, and Laura Gonzalez is moving on. No end in sight for Laura. In for Laura as she gets started after a quick break. 3 minutes left on the clock as Laura shakes it out. Looking to see if she'll have any company on the rope, but I think Brittany Weiss is getting close. Less than 5 reps to go as she looks to catch Laura Gonzalez. Opposite sides of the floor, Brittany Weiss now onto the dubs. Laura and Brittany, ironically coming in today tied for 39th place. Looking to have a better day number 2 with time winding down. Brittany and Laura. hoping to get to that dumbbell with time to spare. Lara's having a little bit of a hard time. She's breaking. Hand up in the air though for Lara. And that is it for the dumps for Lara Gonzalez-Marin. 2 minutes to get down the floor. Ten feet in. As Lara seeking to be the first athlete to finish this one up beneath the cap. Does she have the time? Does she have the will? 90 seconds. And here comes, in lane number two, Garrett onto the dumps. Her and Weiss duking it out for second. Just over 1 minute to go. Lara Gonzalez. 55, now 60 feet in. 1 minute to go. Call back 5 feet. Ladies and gentlemen, 45 seconds to go. Let's help out Lara. As Brittany Weiss gets going. 40 seconds left. Fighting to stabilize that dumbbell overhead. It's going to be 30 feet and 30 seconds. Almost there, Lara, 25 feet. 20 seconds and 15 feet. You can get louder than that, Atlanta, 10 feet. We've got 10 seconds as we get ready to count it down in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and time. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Awesome work by our athletes. So we're going to have to go to the official scoring to see if she did indeed finish beneath the cap. But let's give a big round of applause to Lara Gonzalez, your Heat 1 winner. And all the ladies of Heat number 1, what a great way to start off our day. An exciting Heat number 3, that's some foreshadowing for the rest of our individual female athletes. Heat number 2 coming up next.
Here come the athletes of Heat 2.
Well, we've seen the men attack event number 3. Now we get a chance to see the ladies attack this. A little bit of a chipper from the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta, Georgia, at the Atlantic Regional. I'm Jeff Ryan alongside James Hobart. We'll hear from Amanda Crittens a little bit later as we get set for Heat number 2 of event number 3. And again, a chipper. We're going to go down one side of the floor, back down the other.
Yeah, we have those lunges at the tail ends of this workout, but what really matters is the meat and potatoes in the middle, the wall ball, the 10 rope climb, and the 50 wall ball shots at 20 pounds here for the ladies. To get all this done under the time cap in 16 minutes, they're going to have to move there and stay steady on the rope climbs. Having a plan is going to help.
Let's take a look at how they're going to line up here in Heat 2. For the higher-ranked athletes in the middle, Scholl in lane 4, Fletchman 5, Haley Adams in lane 6, the youngest individual ever in a regional event.
She struggled yesterday on the dumbbell snatch ring dip workout, but it was just so impressive to see her poise and focus as she was going through the workout. So excited to watch her take this one on.
Already has qualified as a teen, so enjoying this experience. I am sure a seventh in the place finish in event one, then in the lower 30s in event number two. But Haley Adams right now not in a bad spot overall. She's 22nd in the rankings.
She had a really impressive finish in event one, and this similar in time domain maybe will play to her strengths.
Well, she's already got that 1,000 meter, that death stare ready for the start, and she is on her way.
Now, like we've said before, this workout isn't won in this first 100-foot lunge, but a couple of things I'm already looking at is that how the athletes step with that dumbbell overhead. Do the athletes stop when they bring their feet together, or do they step through? Because stepping through is going to make that a little bit faster. Might be a sign of things to come for their proficiency on the back half lunges.
One thing they'll have to be careful, if they do the step through, they're very smooth. They will need to make sure they open the hip up at the top, not short step it. But I know what you're saying. If you can step through, that transition down the floor much quicker.
Cycle time is just a little bit faster. Like you said, they do have to make sure they hit full extension as they step through. But the rest, the speed, the pacing is up to them.
Jordan Adcock out of CrossFit South, spun west in Durham, North Carolina, 25-year-old. She was on competitive Edge Wilmington's team in 2015. They finished 36th. She will be the first to finish up her lunges onto the double unders. Again, this is just a starter on the lunges and the double unders, as we've talked about earlier in the men's event. Really gets going on the wall balls and the rope climbs, and then back for more wall balls.
You got to be careful at this point in the workout. The first lunge, the 100 double unders for these regional level athletes, not very difficult. For some of us, you know, who struggle with double unders, that's where you're going to get some built-in rest. But I imagine they'll get these in two sets, maybe on broken. You got to be careful not to go too fast, because you don't want to wreck yourself for that first set of 50 wall balls at 20 pounds going up with that 9-foot target. It's a tall order.
Take a look across the floor. That's Danielle Lopez in the front of your screen in the white next to her, Paige Henry in the pink shorts, and again, Jordan Adcock in those blue shorts. Lopez out of CrossFit Soul Miami. She was on their team last year that did really well in the games, an 11th place finish. Looks like Sarah Scholl will be the first of the wall balls in lane number 4. Multi-time regional athlete, her highest finish in the Northeast back in 2013 when she finished 17th, a track and field athlete back in her college days at Georgetown. Next to her in the white, that is Melissa Alonzo, another one of the CrossFit Soul athletes that was on that team a year ago. They've gone individual this season. Back in the middle, it's Haley Adams, College Hill CrossFit, Greensboro, North Carolina. Finished second in the 14-15-year-old girls division, and the champion, of course, Michaela Stefano, on a team on CrossFit Hype's team here in this regional. So we have the top two fittest athletes in the 14 to 15 who will be aging up this year into the 16-17-year-old division.
And not only that, Allison Weiss, who's competing for College Hill CrossFit's team,
right,
I believe won the 16-17-year-old female division. So all sorts of fit young ladies here this weekend showing up and doing an amazing job.
Stans is 5'6", and she's already through the first 25 wall balls. And we talked about this earlier. Wall balls, a taller athlete favors it, but at 5'6", even though she's shooting to a lower target, the blue line, moving very efficiently.
Yeah, like we said, though, you know, fitness favors the fit. I've been really impressed with Haley's just in overall metabolic capacity. She took a seventh place in event one, which is a really long grinder. We saw her struggle with some upper body strength on those ring dips, especially at higher volume. So I'm curious to see how she handles the rope climbs.
That second set, we'll watch for the hands to go up as Sarah Scholl in the red top getting some quick chalk, and that's Mackenzie Clincham in the black, who is in the middle of your screen, off to the right of the white. Again, Melissa Alonzo in the white. But that is Sarah Scholl out of Herndon, Virginia, CrossFit 286. Brandon Steeple chase for the Hoyas at Georgetown, a 13th and a 30th place finish yesterday on day one.
I've seen Sarah compete for a really long time. She competed out of the Northeast for a very long time. And, you know, she's one of those athletes who just has some really high highs and really low lows throughout the weekend. So in some cases, you don't know where she's going to show up in an event.
Here's Haley Adams on her way up the rope.
Really nice job by Haley trying to get the feet on the rope as soon as possible. She had to do a second pull there to get up to the top. Looks like the judge is telling her, hey, you have to touch the blue billboard, not just the black turnbuckle where the rope is hanging.
Adams gets the crossbar that time.
A little bit slow, but patient and successful.
Sarah Scholl back up the rope. And obviously you're wanting to go as fast as you can, but also some patience pays off in the long run as well. Scholl looked like she had a couple of rope climbs down in lane number four. So take a look across, just a couple of athletes still remaining on the wall balls.
Climbing the rope does things to you. You know, you got so much else to focus on. You forget to do things like breathe. You know, why do rope climbs get us so out of breath? Well, because you're trying to move fast, hold your breath, climb the thing. You just got to remember to be a little bit patient here. You know, it really is one of those movements where sometimes slow is smooth, smooth is fast. It's not just fast is fast.
And one area you can burn a lot of energy, obviously on the legless portion, you got to have a tight grip. But always you hear the coaches tell you, if you're doing a regular rope climb, the legs don't really have to have the death grip on it. Use the legs. Have that to steady yourself.
Yeah, the more upper body pulling you're going to use here, the worse it's going to be for you in the long run. You want to try and use those legs once you get that footlock to almost stand yourself up. And she's right here trying too hard. That was actually pretty impressive. I think trying too hard to get the footlock in a little bit too early, but she's just using the top of the legs, the thighs, to pinch that rope in order to help herself climb up. That was a way to adapt and overcome for the young athlete, Haley Adams. I'm impressed by that.
Smart move there. She kind of touched the crossbar, but that's where the turnbuckle was. So she took a quick look down to the judge to get approval and then retouched the blue crossbar.
Yeah, I guess, you know, at any level of the sport, if you've been a champ, you gain some poise. And, you know, she's been close to the top, that top spot for the 14-15 division. So no surprise, she already knows a couple tricks here to help get herself ahead in this workout.
She's on the back half of the rope climbs now. So six down now for Haley Adams. She moves into her seventh. We go down to lane number two. Your leader right now, Meg Reardon. Meg Reardon out of 12 State CrossFit in Raleigh, North Carolina. Of course, her sister on a team as well.
Yeah, and Meg made it to the games last year. Was expecting a stronger showing from here coming to the regional this weekend. But so far, she has a 29th and a 20th. I'm sure she's looking for a big heat win here to try and move herself up the leaderboard.
33rd of the games a year ago, took third on the regional podium last season, moved from the Northern California regional back in 2014, where she was 27th at the games a year ago. She had three top 15 events, including a third place finish in the suicide sprint.
And you ask yourself, what's Meg doing that helped herself, that's helping her pull ahead of Haley here? And you'll notice as Meg goes back to the rope climb, she's able to use her upper body strength a little bit more efficiently to get a couple legless pulls in there to get herself higher on the rope. That allows her to get a foot lock in.
Training partners, Whitney Galen, who got that event 2-win yesterday. Of course, Margo Alvarez out of the South, who qualified for the games.
Not a bad group to train with.
Last rope climb for Meg Reardon. North Carolina and 12 State CrossFit. Meg Reardon now on the back half of this event. And we'll go in reverse. Wall balls on her right, then 25 to her left. Back to the double unders and then on to the lunges. Back to Haley Adams in lane number six, and she's going up for her last rope climb.
I will say it's not fast, it's not efficient, but for her, trying to conserve that upper body strength by pinching that rope early with the legs, really, really smart. And she's got about, and there she is back to wall ball.
There's a look at your youngest regional athletes here, including Allison Weiss, Luke Webster, Brittany Weiss. Couple individual, a couple of team. So those are your two that are on the wall balls. Haley Adams in the yellow top, and now they'll be joined by Meg Reardon down there in the green top and the white top next to her. Looks like Melissa Alonzo in lane number three now is back on her wall balls in the white tank top and across it, Seoul, Miami. In a 15th and a 32nd a year ago, was on the regional championship team who finished 11th at the games. Lane number two, back to Meg Reardon. So Reardon in the green, in the white, Melissa Alonzo. So the leaders, Reardon in first, Adams in second, Alonzo in third. As we stand right now, nearing the 10-minute mark. A 16-minute time cap, trying to beat Laura Gonzalez-Barron, who was right at the cap, left her dumbbell behind in the prior heat. A few more athletes moving on to the wall balls. Looks like Brooke Haas, Jordan Adcock back onto the wall balls. And Meg Reardon in the lead. In a 33rd place appearance, or finished last year at the games. Haley Adams on her second set of 25.
You know, if you're in this heat and you're competing against Haley Adams and you're seeing her in that first, you know, vying for that first place spot, you got to be thinking for some of these ladies, she's 9-15 years they're younger. I mean, that's absolutely amazing. And probably you got to go home and kind of rethink the attack plan for your regionals and your training when a young girl like this shows up and starts mopping the floor with half the field.
Well, probably if you're a regional veteran, you're probably thinking, well, I've got this this individual rookie. Even though she was great in the team division, she's up with the women now, with the ladies. Maybe she'll be a little bit intimidated. But remember when we started, she just had that kind of death stare, that focus looking ahead. Even being in the games in the team division, she's not intimidated whatsoever out there.
Not one bit.
I got a feeling that's a look we'll see in years to come. That'll be one of those trademark. Boy, when Haley Adams steps up to the start, Matt,
it's going to be a meme.
Look,
it's going to be a meme, yeah, pretty soon.
Meg Reardon is off the wall ball. She'll make her way to the jump rope. 100 double unders and then the lunge. Now Haley Adams that very far behind her. So again, it's Reardon and Adams, and Alonzo was in third. So you have Reardon in the green on your left, Adams in the yellow on to the right.
Adams doing a nice job here in the jump of the double. And if you watch her feet staying on the ball of the foot, Reardon, as you watch her jump, it looks like she's ending up being a little bit more flat-footed. It goes toe, ball of the foot, and the heels almost hitting the ground in between jumps. She's having to bend the knees. That's going to waste some, you know, bleed out some efficiency there. We'd like to see her be more on the ball of the foot as she's jumping up and down. You can see her straining through those double unders. Certainly, they're not made easier by the 100 wall balls she just had to do, but we want to see that athlete stay efficient on the ball of the foot.
Adams may have passed Reardon at this point. We'll see who comes off first, but tied for third is Melissa Alonzo and Jordan Adcock right now. But it was Reardon that got off the wall balls first. Adams, I believe, has broken once. Reardon has broken a few times. We'll see who puts it down to step forward. Adams breaks. That may be it. Yep, she drops the jump rope and is ready to go. And Reardon still trying to finish up her double unders. But she gets in it under the cap, and she's got takes 2.5 minutes roughly to do it, she will have the event lead.
There's no specific way you have to hold the dumbbell overhead, you know, as long as it is locked out overhead and you are lunging. You see she's kind of just letting that dumbbell rest back on that wrist. Nice to have some of that youth flexibility. We can see her struggling with that weight, however. She looks a little bit shaky as she steps. I'm not super surprised by that. We know we talked about upper body strength, especially in pressing motions being an issue for her yesterday. But she's making some really solid work here of these lunges, but she's got some other girls she has to keep at bay.
Jordan Adcock here in the blue shorts of lane 8, pulling even with her, and they both let it hang off the back. I would say this is similar when you catch a kettlebell snatch. You can kind of release your grip, let it hang between the index finger and the thumb rest on your forearm. A little bit more difficult to do. You're not going to do a dumbbell snatch like that, but you can hold it on this lunge.
Well, if you got the flexibility for it, you can let it hang on the tissues there. You know, it's like that might save some of that upper body musculature from having to actually actively push up into the dumbbell and lock out.
Say about a 5-foot lead for Haley Adams. She's a little bit over a length ahead. Jordan Adcock, and she goes down again and loses the dumbbell. So Adcock will overtake her.
Now we know that you can use whatever arm you want. You wonder at this point, Haley's been all on one arm the entire time. Is it time to switch? Some athletes have one side. You see her now going to the left side. Some athletes have just one side that's much stronger than the other.
Adcock looking to bring it home. Couple of more lengths and she will be in and will have the time to beat. One more step for the Durham, North Carolina athlete, Jordan Adcock at 15-15. Haley Adams still back. She switched back to the right arm. When you talk about one arm may be stronger than the other, but you also have to consider over 100 feet how fatigued that comes. Maybe your less dominant arm at this point may have a little bit more strength. We'll see if she can finish it out. She's getting pressured by Melissa Alonzo in lane number 3, and Alonzo will overtake her. Alonzo, maybe 2, maybe 3 more steps. Alonzo will play it smart. If she'd have gone in 2, that would have been a huge step to take. So Alonzo is in, just in under the cap. Adams is going to time cap out. Great performance, though, by a 16-year-old.
Yeah, it's a bummer for the young athlete. But you know what's nice for her? She's got lots of time to get better. And she has some clear elements that she can go home and practice immediately, because she also has some things she's really good at.
But it's Jordan Adcock who gets in at 15-15 unofficial time.
The key for Adcock here was she just stayed in striking distance the entire time on the wall ball and the rope climb. She didn't get too lost, push too hard, and burn out there. And then really what allowed her to take off is when she got on that dumbbell, she lunged better than everybody else, was able to pass Haley Adams here, who had a little bit of struggle with the load of that dumbbell. Jordan was able to keep moving, take some quick rests there, and looked really strong once she switched arms to finish that 100-foot walking lunge.
Jordan Adcock is the event leader right now. Jordan Adcock and Haley Adams are on the floor with Amanda Krenz.
We're going to start with Jordan. Jordan, you moved really well through that event.
Thank you.
Was there a hardest part for you?
The hardest part was probably the wall balls and just picking it back up after I was breaking up my sets. I wanted to be done.
Yeah, you did a great out there. Someone who was chasing you down, you guys were neck and neck there for a little bit, is Haley. Haley, you're the youngest individual competitor. What has it been like for you to be out here on this competition floor with these athletes?
I really can't believe I made it here, to be honest. I mean, I know I have to take in the fact that I'm not matured yet, so it's hard to compare myself. So the fact that I'm even on this floor is amazing to me, so, yeah.
What sort of expectations do you have for yourself?
Obviously my main goal is to win the team game, so this was just a little experience, and next year I'll be back to play with the big girls for real.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.
What a great attitude for Haley Adams. Get the experience, but hey, I'm coming for you.
Not matured yet is just code for I'm only going to get better. Watch out. That was fantastic. Amazing job to both those girls. Jordan Adcock really steady there to finish that off.
2 heats down, 2 heats to go from the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta. Here we go for heat number three of event number three for the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta, Georgia. Day number two in the Atlantic Regional. I'm Jeff Prime alongside James Hobart. We'll hear later on from Amanda Krenz. Well, a time to beat and under the time cap, unofficial of 15:15. We'll see what these heat three athletes can do in this workout.
Wow, from what I've seen so far, I wish we could just fast forward through everything up until that final 100-foot walking lunge. With that 55-pound dumbbell overhead, we've seen so much change there. Ladies who want to stay in this hunt have to be consistent, stay in striking distance of the lead athlete for those 50 wall ball shots, 10 rope climbs, 50 wall ball shots, and just not make any huge mistakes on the front half of the overhead lunge and the double under.
Taking a look at our lane assignments right now. Whitney Stevenson in lane one. Cheryl Nasso in lane number five. She's currently in 11th place overall, and Nasso with 120 points, only 35 points out of a qualifying spot with four events remaining.
A lot of regional experience out of Cheryl. She's been really strong in longer chipper workouts. As long as we don't have a huge technical element, I think if she can stay steady on the rope climbs, we'll see a good finish from her.
Kalina Ladaris, yesterday, the 20th, came back with a 12th place finish, and Kalina sitting in 14th place. And they're underway. James, you and I were talking about going back to Kalina Ladaris being 14th and Nasso being 11th. With the restructuring of the regionals 3 years ago and going to the game scoring system, it's made such a difference. On day two in the old regional format, you knew who the three or five athletes were going to compete for those top three spots. With the restructure 3 years ago, you have two and a half heats. You have a lot more athletes still alive on day two that can make big jumps before Sunday.
Yeah, it's just basically that before the point restructuring, if you had a really bad event, you were essentially, for lack of a better word, screwed for the rest of the weekend. And now a bad event still hurts, but it doesn't hurt as much as a really good event helps. So for some of these ladies, they could still edge their way back up maybe into that top half or top 10.
Here is Kalina Ladaris. She is first through on the dumbbell walking lunges.
She looked a little unsteady coming down even this first 100 feet. So I think that's something to keep in mind. Even if she powers through this first, through this middle part of the workout, how is she going to fare on those dumbbell overhead walking lunges at the end?
Again, she's been to the games multiple times. Once on the team in 15 with CrossFit Milford's podium team that finished second in 2013. She was 19th as an individual.
No doubt, a lot of experience, very talented athlete.
Tulsa Lamb Casey finishing up her overhead lunge. Now all the athletes onto the double unders. Ladaris breaks again on the 100 double unders in a white top. Just looks over the judge, checks to see how many she has remaining. And the event's really going to start up here once they get off the jump rope, get on the wall balls. And she was first to get to the double liners, but she's broken several times. And now we'll see in lane number four, it's going to be Meredith Root who gets ahead of everyone. Root started 22nd yesterday, then moved up with a ninth place finish in event number two. Next to her, it's Cheryl Nasso. So Nasso's one we're going to watch.
I believe Meredith Root has a twin sister also competing on 336 CrossFit who's finished off the day in the top five. So pretty talented athletes in that family.
Root was ninth in the Atlantic yesterday. Only 73 of 254 women have finished under the cap. That's just 29% here in event number three. Tells you how much of a challenge this event is. And we're talking about the fittest 280 total, including this weekend, females on the planet.
I mean, these athletes are absolutely amazing. It'd be nice if you could have that information before you started testing regional workouts to know where you can put your effort into. Hey, everybody's going to finish this one. Don't test it that much. But this one, if you can finish, you're really going to pull yourself up the leaderboard.
She's on to her second set of 25. Get out of CrossFit RDU in Raleigh, North Carolina. Meredith Root there in the blue tank top. Lindsay Eater in the green tank top off to the right. On the left, Cheryl Nasso in the black top and the black pants. So right now, it is Root in the lead, checking the rep count with her judge. Cheryl Nasso doing the same thing. Got a Maverick CrossFit. Five-time regional athlete. Here we go, lane number four, Meredith Root. Done with the wall balls, and she'll be on to the 10 rope climbs. Every time they climb a rope, they'll move the magnetic marker on the post up one spot. They have to touch the crossbar. It's blue all the way across. It's white over lane one, but they have to touch that crossbar, not the turnbuckle, not what holds the rope. And you don't want to take a chance. You don't want to touch, you know, parallel on the cross. You don't want to leave any doubt to the judge.
Now you want to make it as clear as possible, because if you get up there and come down and they say no rep, that's a lot. It's 15 seconds of lost work.
Just want to give it a nice high five. Get the full hand on there if at all possible.
And Root's doing a really good job moving up this rope. What I think you want to see from these ladies here is that as soon as they get enough purchase on that rope with their legs, they do so. You know, you don't want to see any extra pulls. That was really nice. Any extra pulls needed of that legless rope climb, so that's going to wear you down. So maybe two or three legless pulls as soon as you can get a little bit of grip on that rope. Get your footlock in and start using those to assist.
Just saw Trisha Wazalewski at a CrossFit Bound in Kennesaw just north of Atlanta. She was on Bound's team the last couple of seasons. But back to lane number five, Cheryl Nasso. So right now it is Root and Wazalewski at Nasso, your top three. Nasso's kind of falling off the pace just a little bit on the rope climbs.
And you can see she has to use that body kip to help get herself up the rope. That's definitely going to slow her down there. You want to see athletes be able to pull quickly with just the arms. The more body kip they have to pull in, a lot of lost efficiency there.
Well, we talked about it earlier, the difference between a rope that hangs off the ground and a long rope that stays on the ground. You do the body kip trying to find that rope with your feet, that rope swinging around a lot more.
Yeah, and meanwhile, your arms are just hanging in one place. You're not gaining any ground. I think, you know, Cheryl, as fit as she is and as good as her capacity is, it's going to be hard for her to keep pushing back up into the top spot of this heat.
Trisha Wazalewski, 27 years old, 5'4" again. She's been to the games on Bound's 25th place team a year ago. 2 years ago, CrossFit Bound was 14th at the games yesterday. Didn't start off so hot with a 32nd event one, but she came back with a top 10. She finished 10th in event number two. 20th place with 92 points. And 92 points puts her right around, I believe, 62 points away from a top five. So she's got 400 points out there to try to make up some ground, but she does need to have a really nice heat, and she's doing that right now.
More than a nice heat.
Yeah.
She probably need to win this event.
Yeah.
But never want to say all hope is lost.
Root in first. Whitney Stevens is starting to make a bit of a move over at lane number one. Whitney Stevenson again, trying to make a push at a CrossFit Palm Beach in Jupiter, Florida. 22nd in the Southeast region.
A little bit taller athlete than some of the other athletes out there at 5'8". So that's going to be another little piece of assistance as we try and make our way up that rope.
Pair of rope climbs remaining for the 28-year-old. 19th place of 94 points. A little bit like Haley Adams, steadies the rope, pinches the rope between the thighs, and brings the feet up to try to get that J-hook.
You'll notice, though, as soon as she gets that footlock, the feet start to slip down. That's not something you want to see or feel when you're on the rope. I'm sure if anybody's been there before. She needs to try and get that bottom foot up a little bit higher, make herself a, I know I've talked about sandwiches already today, but make herself a foot rope sandwich. I'm going to say I'm just hungry.
Hey, whatever cue works. Whitney taking a look. She's probably peeking over the clock to her right to time out her rest.
which is a smart thing to do. You can get lost in rest. And that one was a little bit better. Still seeing a little bit of slippage there.
So she's through her rope climbs, and here is Meredith Root, who is in second place. Allison Scuds in third, but Root on her final rope climb, it looks like, who lost her footing.
And I know you only have so much time to practice. I'd like to know how many of these athletes back home, you know, they probably put a mark on a rope and said, hey, I won't start climbing with my feet until I get above that. But how many back home actually cut a rope and set it up like this? Because this thing is a whole different beast than a rope that hangs all the way to the floor.
Lane one, Whitney Stevens begins her first 25 wall balls. Big no rep there, switches placement. So Meredith Root will drop down to third. Meanwhile, Allison Scud takes the second spot. Whitney Stevenson still in first place in lane number one, top of your screen. Lane seven, Kalina Ladaris.
And we said it before, she had some bobbles in the early part of this workout, lunges, screwed up on the double unders, but it is the middle of this workout that matters. And we know Kalina has an engine. She's chewing through these wall balls.
Ladaris on the left of the white top, Scuds on the right in the green top. Ladaris and Scuds right now going back and forth for second place while Whitney Stevenson still has the lead. And Scuds in the green. Here we go back to the first place athlete, Whitney Stevenson, on the back half of the 50 wall balls. And a 16-minute time gap here at event number three. Jordan Hancock, 15:14.26, did it a heat ago.
We talked earlier about Ben Smith's movement in the wall ball. This is Whitney Stevenson doing a really nice job here of just moving well with the wall ball shot. Heels down, knees out, clearly below parallel, torso nice and upright. Not only is her height advantage going to play into that, but her movement advantage is all going to make her a little bit more prepared to execute this workout. That stuff is all going to add up to a good finish.
Long look there. Trying to make this final charge up. Meredith Root, her final rope climb, gets the hook, slaps that crossbar.
She throws the rope away. had enough of that.
So she'll be on to the wall balls. So it's Stevenson, Ladaris, and Scudge, your top three. Back to Whitney Stevenson, 22nd seed out of the Southeast. Down with the wall balls, on to the double unders, and then to the lunge.
And Kalina's right there with her. We saw Kalina struggle earlier on the double unders, so Stevenson even an early no rep there.
So Stevenson and Ladaris both breaking early.
This might just be who can get to 100 via sets of five the fastest.
Stevenson seems to have found her rhythm. Ladaris had a little trouble the first set of 100 double unders.
And both of these ladies very aware of what's going on around them there. You see them both looking left to right to see where the other is at when the other is broken. So
you get that fatigue, and Ladaris, you see the forearm starting to move a little bit instead of just the wrist. And Ladaris had the lead. Kalina, over Scuds.
Kalina coming through with a nice big chunk of double unders there.
But it's Whitney Stevenson. Looks like she is maintaining that pace up top in the black top, purple pants. Ladaris down there. Now here comes Allison Scuds in the green top.
You know, if Allison Scuds could get these unbroken, 100 double unders unbroken is only about a minute worth of work. Yeah, that's tiring, but she could make up some ground on these two other ladies here with Kalina and Whitney.
Joined by Colson Lamb Casey, who had a 36 to start off, but then a sixth place finish in event two yesterday. Whitney Stevenson done. Here she goes, 100 feet of overhead lunges.
And I just saw Kalina look over at her, so she's 100% aware of who she's got to chase down right now.
Scuds will break.
I like that I saw Whitney use her second hand to assist getting that dumbbell up just to make that a little bit easier, have that thing locked out.
Here comes Kalina Ladaris. She's got the dumbbell overhead. And Stevenson, even though she started fairly early, does not have that big of a lead over Ladaris.
Ladaris just got a critical no rep there. Had to take the dumbbell back almost two spots, about 10 feet. So each little box on that lane is a 5 foot increment. So 10 feet's a big difference here now out of that 100. It's 10% of that entire distance.
That no rep, she may have only had about a 10 or 15 foot lead. It grew to about 50, but she breaks, and here comes Ladaris. Ladaris making up ground quickly. Stevenson has to pick that dumbbell up.
And right now for Ladaris, this is 100% willpower. We saw her bobble and struggle with that lunge on the front half, and now she is just driven to catch up to Stevenson.
Stevenson's broken a couple times. Ladaris had that no rep. Ladaris about 2.5 lengths behind. Now about 2 lengths behind, slowly reeling her in. Does she have enough time remaining? Enough distance, and that's huge. She drops Stevenson in the distance, closing in. 10 feet to go. About 3 more lunges, maybe just 2. She'll take the big step, a little unsteady. Oh, dropped it. She's going to have to come back. That leaves the door open for Ladaris.
Ladaris still has a lot of ground to cover here.
And she drops. Stevenson, 2 steps, and she'll have to bring the dumbbell across. And Whitney Stevenson, the new time to beat, a little over 15 minutes. About 15:02 unofficially.
She may have surprised herself right there.
Here comes Ladaris. Ladaris, one more lunge. Stands it up. And Kalina is in about 15:24. So now we have a race for third. Lane number 6, Allison Scuds in the green top. Right behind her in lane number 3, about 3 lengths behind. In the green top is Lindsay Eder out of Death by CrossFit in Princeton, West Virginia. Lane number 8, as she puts it down, here comes Kelly Boblett at the time cap, and they'll all finish about even across the floor. Whitney Stevenson, though, unofficially a 15:02, just holding off Kalina Ladaris.
Yeah, and you know, we talk a lot about being aware of where your competitors are. I think Kalina put herself in a position where she had to chase down someone and go a pace that she wasn't ready to go. Stevenson made up a lot of time on the rope climb and the wall ball, using advantage of her height. She moved better on the wall ball, not only just larger sets, but the movement was of a better quality there. That helped her out, but where she really stood out in this workout was with those overhead walking lunges. She kept her eyes in her own lane, was steady there, had a little fumble at the end, had to go back 5 feet, took a breath, but still finished strong. I think that was a really impressive finish. Nice example of staying in your own lane and how that can help you win the race.
One more heat remaining for the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta. The best part about coming to a CrossFit regional, you get to get up and close and personal with the athletes. And here comes heat number 4, down the tunnel onto the competition floor. Event number three, this is going to be heat number four in the Georgia World Congress Center in Atlanta. I'm Jeff Breibel alongside James Hobart. We'll be joined later by Amanda Perens.
You can't save anything for day three, events five and six. That's right now, events three and four. These ladies need to push because there's not a lot of space between 10th and 5th if they want to claw into that top five spot.
Just 34 points, and we've got a tie in points for first place, but Bridgers with the event win as the tiebreaker over Cassidy Lance McWhorter. This should be a great match.
Yeah, and I agree with you, Jeff. I don't think you're going to see a lot of change between spots one and two. This comes down to a race for three, four, and five.
Emily Bridgers, your overall leader with the tiebreaker. Her region, the Atlantic, saying, hey, you want it, come and get it.
And again, look, yeah, exactly. If you want to come and get it, and I think if anybody's going to beat her, it's going to be on those wall ball, taking advantage of maybe some height there, moving faster on the rope climbs. But as I've said all day, I want to see a race on the overhead walking lunge, 55-pound dumbbell overhead, 100 feet to finish. That's what I want to see right now.
There are your lane assignments with Bridgers in five. Lance McWhorter currently in a tie, but again, Bridgers with the overall lead. That is lane five and six. Here is Brianna Evans, Atlanta owned Brianna Evans at a CrossFit Identity, hanging on to the final spot. She has a one-point lead over the veteran, Anna Tobias. Again, you know her probably most commonly as Tunnicliffe. Now, Anna Tobias, but she's just a point behind Brianna Evans.
I think she could be a really big threat in this event. Plays to her strengths from a conditioning standpoint, just as the skill and the weight of the dumbbell or the wall ball hold her back.
Underway in the 100-foot overhead lunge. Lane number four, Whitney Galen in the green top. And I thought would have a good, at least the 100-foot overhead lunge. She lost it there, but I thought that would favor her.
That's all right. Now that you mention her, you know, I think a stronger athlete here and a taller athlete has a slight physical advantage in this workout. It's just if her fitness can keep up. We saw some athletes in the South, Marco Coppola, male, totally dismantle this workout. Yep. He was one of the probably the largest male athlete competing.
And it's Tobias, the first across that long stride. And no denying her fitness, four-time games vet, a couple of top 10 finishes, including the 10th a year ago in Carson.
Not to mention a gold medal Olympian from Beijing in sailing. So she can do it all.
Boy, she had her ropes in, and I know they all set their ropes up when they come out, but there was no hesitation. Dumbbell down, up, and into the double unders.
We talk about the little stuff mattering, and, you know, by the end of the week, everybody's like, oh, well, so-and-so only missed it by one single rep. No, it's not one single rep. There's hundreds of little things that you could have done better to make your weekend go well. And no doubt someone with that level of experience takes advantage of it.
So Anna Tobias, the early lead. Let's take a look at how difficult this event has been. Only 28% of the female athletes have beaten the cap. That's 75 of the 264 coming in to this Atlantic region. Four of them. Only four so far, and we've had 30 athletes go.
And even if you realize you're not going to make the top five or go up to Madison, it's nice to have that badge of honor knowing you were the select few that made it through an event or had a heat win or set an event record.
And Tobias, a little over 2 minutes. On to the wall balls. A little bit off the event record, but not far, about 11 seconds. Lane number five, that's Emily Bridgers. She is your leader by tiebreaker over Cassidy Lance. Again, both with 190 points. Cassidy Lance McWhorter to your left. In lane number six, with the black top and the black tights. And again, Emily Bridgers in the middle, and that's Whitney Glenn, the green, on the right.
Now, this is perfect. If you look at Cassidy on the left, Whitney on the right, they don't have to jump off the ground to hit that wall ball shot. Their feet can stay relatively flat, whereas Emily in the middle, she has to jump a little bit shorter in order to get that wall ball up a little bit higher. That's going to wear her down more throughout this workout. She's got a lot of fitness, but is it enough to hang on with those two ladies?
Whitney Galen has already moved on, and we talk about the stronger athlete, a little bit larger athlete, Whitney Galen, moving through onto the right. And Andy Sakamoto on the update show talked about that very thing, that Whitney Galen, a very powerful athlete, can move through this.
Well, if there's anybody who's very familiar with the the travesty of being short and a high wall ball target. It's Annie Sakamoto. I've seen it firsthand, and she's not shy to talk about it herself either.
So all three have moved on to the second 25, but Galen the slight lead over these three. But Anna Tobias off in lane eight still holds the overall lead.
I'll tell you what Emily Bridges is doing well. She might have to work a little harder to make every shot count, but I bet her rests are planned, and she is just shooting it high enough to take a few seconds rest and then get back on it so she can keep chipping away. She's hanging with these girls, doing a really excellent job.
She was 29th at the game a year ago. She would like to return to that 2014 former rookie year when she finished sixth overall. Here's Anna Tobias on her second set. In fact, nearly done, and she is done onto the rope climbs. And she's a game vet from a year ago. We'll watch Bridges. We'll watch Tobias in this heat because they have experience in competition with this type of rope. They saw it in Carson last year. Lane number two, Mackenzie Riley, was on OC3's team a year ago. Finished fifth at the games. Back to Tobias, down to lane number eight.
Just shows you how tight it is at the top. Mackenzie Riley, she's an eighth and a seventh. She's sitting right now in seventh place. So, you know, pretty going to be a close race here. This event is going to matter a lot heading into the end of the day.
So they look like they're all about at the same rope climb. I believe Bridges may have just moved it up into the third spot as Galen just finished. She'll move her marker up to the third placement. Glenn on the right, Bridges in the middle, Lance McWhorter on the left. And again, in a race this tight here in lanes 4, 5, and 6, you sure don't want to mess up and get a no rep. You want to make it absolutely clear you touch that crossbar. Back to lane number two in Mackenzie Riley at a CrossFit North Lake in Charlotte, North Carolina, in an eighth and a seventh place. Yesterday, she sits in seventh. She's just 11 points out of a qualifying position.
The evil chalk bag.
It's just calling your name under fatigue. Come toward the light.
Yeah, it's the siren that misdirects the sailors. If anybody gets that reference.
It's the crossbar. She's really getting through these rope climbs pretty quick. Her and Tobias. Tobias with the lead, and then Riley in second. And we've got a great race for third between Galen Bridges and Lance McWhorter here in the middle three lanes.
Bridges might have just edged up into third there. Okay, there's Anna Tobias moving up onto that eighth rope climb marker.
Tobias, before it's all said and done, again, she's only a point out of qualifying. She's in sixth place. Could see herself as high as third. At least she's too many points behind to catch Bridges and Lance McWhorter. At least on this particular event, she could find herself, depending on how Galen does, up in a third. But the important thing is you see Riley go up. Two names we've not called yet and seen, Dardini and Evans. So Tobias a chance to jump those two athletes. They held the fourth and fifth positions. Tobias doing her last rope climb.
Like we talked about, just a really nice job of getting the feet on the rope as soon as possible, not to have to wear the arms out. That's going to assist her even as she heads into the wall ball.
And you can really tell that height helped. Here is Dardini again. Caroline Dardini with 165 points has an 11-point lead on Anna Tobias. Dardini currently in fourth place, a little bit ahead of Brianna Evans. Dardini out of CrossFit 215 in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And there is the fifth-place athlete coming into Saturday, Brianna Evans, with 155 points out of CrossFit Identity here in her hometown. A former Georgia State University cheerleader. So she went to school here, stayed here, pursue her CrossFit career.
You can hear she's got a lot of support here at the Atlantic Regional right now.
He has one more rope climb remaining. Tobias with five wall balls left before she gets onto the back half on the back 25. Tobias has a little bit of a jump as well that you talked about earlier.
Well, as you get more fatigued, you know, it's like you got to use everything you can to get that ball up there. The arms are going to be the first thing you get tired, so why not use the much stronger legs to give you that little extra pep?
Tobias trying to stay ahead of Brianna Evans. She's just 1 point behind. So once they get on the lunges, whoever edges out the other athlete is going to have that fifth qualifying spot. With only three events to go, without seven events, all of a sudden, you're looking at just three to go, not 400 points out there, just 300 points left after this.
Unless we see something catastrophic, it's going to be a tight, tight race between all the ladies in the top seven heading into Sunday.
Right now, it looks like Tobias, followed by Galen, followed by Lance McWhorter and Emily Bridgers. They're your top four. Galen has moved on to her second 25 on the right of the green top. So Galen and Tobias, it's going to be really fun once they get off these wall ball targets.
And I think for Emily Bridgers, we've talked a lot about, you know, her maybe not having the edge in this event. But this might just be damage control. And to be able to look at a fifth place finish as damage control, if that's where she ends up, that's not a bad start to day two.
Whitney Stevenson, 15:03:13, as you just saw, has the time to beat Tobias down to her last five. And it looks like Whitney Galen down to her last five as well. So they are about even. Tobias off of the wall balls onto the jump rope. Well, we had a hand up for Galen. We don't, so she is losing reps here to Tobias. Tobias all alone. And this is a good place to be all alone. You're in first. Very steady, very relaxed. 15:03:13 by Whitney Stevenson. Now Lance McWhorter, a no rep. She's got less than five. Galen does have the hand up. Now she is onto the rope.
Tobias has a sizable lead over Galen, though. But we've seen so much change on these lunges. Especially if Galen can get in a big chunk of double unders here. Now we have Lance McWhorter stepping up as well. So again, going to be a fantastic finish. There's Mackenzie Riley. Fantastic finish on the overhead walking lunge.
Yeah, this is definitely an event that you can't look at the first lunge and try to make a correlation to what the second lunge is going to look like. Tobias crushed the first one. We'll see what the second one looks like. Galen had a drop, but was still very strong in the lunge.
You know, I think even if you know you're not going to get a huge set, I think you got to get on that dumbbell and start lunging as soon as possible. You putting any distance between yourself and the other competitors is discouraging to them. But if they can look over and be like, oh, she's a little tired, she's waiting to get up that dumbbell, I can catch her. Don't give those guys any hope.
I was going to say, even the mental game of seeing out of the corner of your eye someone snatch it up, even if they've not taken a step, if you've snatched that dumbbell over your head, yeah, all of a sudden you're like, I am behind. And Tobias looks pretty strong on the second lunge. She's still got a ways to go, but quickly goes. She never let it go. Stopped, jerked it back up, and is ready to go.
Put the nail in the coffin. And the other thing I am surprised I haven't seen a lot of athletes do here is maybe break it up into three sets, about 30 feet apiece. That way, just rely on quick arm switches rather than just tiring one arm out to failure.
Galen checking the judge to see how many reps she has remaining. Galen stormed back yesterday with an event two win. And there goes Mackenzie Riley. She now moves into second place. Riley looking very stable here. Tobias may have put too much distance, but I like how Riley looks in the background. Very stable.
But both of these ladies could use a little boost here. Strong one and two finish for event three.
Cassidy Lance McWhorter. Well, she's being no rep. She doesn't know it. It's a loud environment here, and she took about a 10-foot stroll before she realized she was no rep. Here is Anna Tobias. Two more steps.
Yeah, that extra lunge. Heck yeah. Oh, I love it.
Event win in under 13 minutes for Anna Tobias, the Games veteran. Mackenzie Riley making her way down, likely not to be caught. She'll have a second place finish in event number three. And Riley likely to move into the top five after this second place finish. Dardini and Evans still back, so athletes getting in between her and those two athletes. Here is Cassie Lance McWhorter. If she can hold off Bridges behind her, we'll have the overall lead. Cassidy Lance McWhorter will lunge her way into first place all alone.
A little smile and smirk there. She's happy for that one.
Galen and Bridgers, step for step. Who's going to blink? Bridgers, Galen, Bridgers, Galen, Emily Bridgers. That's what you want. You want that push. Nobody flinch. Just a half step ahead for Emily Bridgers, ahead of Whitney Galen. And Brianna Evans back there watching that top five spot slip away. She's still got three events to go, but she's going to be outside the top five going into event four later today as Colleen Lehane in lane number one out of Crucible CrossFit in Jacksonville, Florida, pulls away.
It doesn't make anything more comfortable for these ladies as they head into event number four. Dardini now here, I think she's close to the bottom of this heat for her coming into this event in a fourth place. She needs to keep fighting and stay motivated because maybe she forgets where other athletes ended up in the earlier heat. So she could probably still make some ground here, do some damage control, and try and climb back up in that top five, maybe top 10 standing.
Well, just off the top of my head, I'm going to say Anna Tobias is going to hold the number four spot because Galen finished high enough. But Tobias will move into the top five, and I believe will be fourth overall. Cassie Lance McWhorter, we know, is going to take the overall lead, so she won head-to-head against Emily Bridgers with about 30 seconds remaining in the time cap.
We'll probably see Mackenzie Riley in that fifth place spot.
Right. Seconds remaining in the cap.
It's cool seeing these ladies help each other out, try and get to that finish before that cap.
Colleen's going to be close. One more step. Remember, had to take the dumbbell. She does. She'll get in and under the cap, which, again, we talked about. You finish under the cap, you've done a tremendous job. Only four athletes in the Atlantic had done it prior to this heat. So even though it might not look, you're comparing to the heat, she's probably still got a top 10 in the event. But Anna Tobias wins event number three.
I don't know what to say here. She just looked pretty relentless throughout the entire event. I think her ability to get up on that rope and get her feet on as soon as possible is what gave her a little bit of an extra edge over the rest of the athletes. She stayed steady on the wall ball, but that's not where she wanted. I think it was that rope climb. And then her sturdiness on the lunge was the big turning point there. No one was going to touch her. Once she got moving, she stayed far ahead of Mackenzie Riley.
And it's Tobias again. We have the event win. She's on the floor with Amanda.
Anna, you're known for doing well in these endurance events. Why is that?
I don't know. I like the pain. Maybe my background's a little bit endurance. But I just like the grind. Like, put your head down, get the work done, you know, and it's going to hurt, and it's who can deal with the hurt the most.
How was your experience helping you out this weekend, do you think?
I think knowing that it's not over in one event, you know, you just got to focus on one event at a time. And, you know, at the end, the results will take care of themselves, and you just got to do the best you can in the moment.
Thanks, Anna.
Thank you.
Anna Tobias, 1258.27. Hey, how about this, James? Day number two, this is a blast down here in the Atlantic.
We said it coming into this weekend. Jeff, you called it from the start, is that this was going to be a close race. I still think, you know, spots one and two are going to be really tight, but that three, four, and five is going to just keep us biting our nails.
And that is what it looks like here in the Atlantic. We're going to get an update from the other regions as well. We'll send it back out to HQ, to the update studio.
Sam Farber, Tommy Marquez here with you at CrossFit HQ. Very busy day all across the country. If you are out in Portland, you just saw Anna Tobias rack up another event win. And those of you if you're out in Atlanta, you just saw Anna Tobias with a win. Out in Portland, Fort Vancouver, setting an event record, their second of the day. Let's catch you up on everything going on in the men's leaderboard right now in Portland. It's going to be a very busy, moving day out there for sure. You've got Cody Anderson in first place, 190 points. Ben Stoneberg actually won event one, could not complete event two. That was the big news of day one. And Fitkowski and Seeger currently in fifth and sixth position. A couple of games veterans separated by just 2 points. It's going to be Cole Seeger is going to have some work to do. Both expected to make the games, but right now on either side of that dividing line.
Yeah, and then I think really down in eighth, the person that has to do the best, in my opinion, for today is Joe Scally. Because you look, he had a slow start in day number one, not too strong of a finish in event number one. Comes back with a fourth to close out day number two, but he's in eighth right now, only 6 points back. But the guy he's chasing in fifth is Brent Fikowski. I think Fikowski's going to have a big day today, so that really means he's chasing fourth and third place, Ryan Smith and Mitchell Stevenson. And now you're talking about a little bit bigger point spread here, 19 to 20 points. So he needs to have a strong finish starting with this first event.
Let's get your pick for event number three.
Well, I just mentioned I think he's going to have a big day, but I think it's Brent Fikowski. I think this, just looking at the elements at play, all you got to do is look back to last year and the things he won. Look at what he won. The Ranch Mini Chipper, that's got the heavy wall ball. That shows up in event three. The Climbing Snail, the shortened rope, we won that too. That's right in the middle of this workout. And then you look at the Rope Chipper, ton of double unders, except for the heavy rope. Those shouldn't give him a problem. Assuming he smashes the lunge, which I think he will as a longer athlete, I think this one's right in his wheelhouse.
In the Atlantic region, the men's competition's been very interesting. Only one athlete has been top 10 in every single event. That's Ryan Elrod, who's currently on the wrong side of the dividing line. And then, of course, you have Ben Smith, who had a big event number three, starting to charge up the leaderboard. Still has some work to do with half the competition left. But Ben Smith was very impressive this morning.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to this workout in particular. If you look at the elements at play, it bodes well for him, really, because you got a heavy pull from the floor. You got some midline work. You got a handstand walk. Well, we saw something similar with the midline work and the heavy pull last year in event number five at regionals. He happened to win that. We also saw some odd object pull from the floor plus handstand walking when you're fatigued. 2 years ago at the games in the soccer chipper, you know what? He won that one too. So I think this is another one that lines up well for him to keep moving up the leaderboard.
Event four coming up in the Atlantic region. Who do you like?
Well, if the circumstances were different, I might go with someone like Travis Mayer or Noah Olsen, who I think might blast this workout too. But I'm going to go with Ben Smith again, particularly because of the sense of urgency that he showed in event number three, not just with his fitness, but with his strategy. You look at how he moved through the wall balls and the rope climbs that were the middle portion of that workout. If you looked up an instruction manual on how to do rope climbs with this shortened rope, it would have a picture of Ben Smith in there and just say, do that, because he did these perfectly. Two pulls legless, pinches his feet up there to the top. That's when he making his move. That's how we won this event. We saw James Hobart mention it earlier, just the efficiency of movement. That benefits you in the long run, and I think that's what's going to happen with Ben Smith.
Men's competition rolling on in both the West and Atlantic regions. Here's how you can watch both at the same time. You just got to get multiple devices out. You can go to games.crossfit.com, our Facebook page. Go to the CrossFit Games page for it. YouTube.com/CrossFitHQ. All those will give you the main feeds. And of course, we have our great second screen experience as well, giving you the raw feed, behind the scenes looks, and much, much more at Facebook.com/CrossFit. Updated leaderboard, West Region, the team CrossFit Fort Vancouver. No surprise here. Three first place finishes and a second. They are in the top spot, but CrossFit Marysville, after a strong start, they won event number one. They are now down in sixth place, 1 point out of qualifying position with 1 day still left to go. We are ready to get you back to live competition in Portland and Atlanta. Men ready to take the floor once again. Let's get you back out to competition.